Olisiko se nyt sitten toi? Joo, näkyykö nyt? Joo, näet. Joo. Hyvä. No niin, tosiaan aloitellaan sitten pikkuhiljaa meidän Laatumaria-hankkeen ja Kekkilä BVP:n järjestämää pensasmustikka-webinaaria. Mun nimi on Minna Pohjola ja mä toimin tosiaan ProAgria Länsi-Suomessa marjantuotannon asiantuntijana ja myös tämän Laatumaria-hankkeen vetäjänä. Ja nyt tosiaan tähän alkuun, niin ajattelin ihan parilla sanalla tästä hankkeesta ja sitten ihan pensasmustikan tuotannosta myös vähän yleistä ja sitten mennään itse esityksiin. Tässä nyt tosiaan ihmisiä vielä tulee pikkuhiljaa tässä mukaan, mutta meinattiin, että aloitellaan nyt kuitenkin tämä webinaari sitten, että pysytään aikataulussa ja näin. Mä pistän tuosta kuvankin pois. Eli tosiaan niin tervetuloa tosiaan kaikille vielä tähän webinaariin ja tosiaan tämä on nyt sitten Laatumaria-hankkeen ja Kekkilä BVP:n yhteistyötä tämä webinaari. Ja tosiaan tämä Laatumaria-hanke on nyt sitten toimii tuossa Satakunnan ja Varsinais-Suomen alueilla. Meillä hankkeen tavoitteena on tosiaan marjatuotannon ylipäätään kannattavuuden parantaminen ja testataan uusia viljelytekniikoita ja uusia lajikkeita ja pellon kasvukuntoa ja niin poispäin. Ja tämä Laatumaria-hanke on tosiaan Luonnonvarakeskuksen ja ProAgria Länsi-Suomen yhteishanke. Ja täällä Lounais-Suomessa meillä on jo todella merkittävää marjantuotantoa ja muun muassa neljännes kaikesta mansikasta kotimaassa niin tulee jo Lounais-Suomesta. Myös pensasmustikan osalta niin Lounais-Suomi on erittäin merkittävää viljelyaluetta, eli noin 30% kaikista pensasmustikkaviljelmistä sijaitsee täällä Lounaisessa Suomessa. Ja tämän Laatumaria-hankkeen yhtenä tavoitteena on siis myös pensasmustikan viljelyosaamisen lisääminen, ja siihen myös tämä tämänpäiväinen webinaarikin sitten liittyy. Ja tosiaan tätä webinaaria on ollut järjestämässä erittäin keskeisessä roolissa, tosiaan Eija Lankinen Kekkilä BVP:stä, joten Eijallekin on iso kiitos tässä vaiheessa tämän webinaarin järjestelyistä, eli ilman Eijan hyviä kontakteja ei tässä varmaankaan tänään oltaisi. Ja ihan muutama sananen vielä pensasmustikan tuotannosta Suomessa ja vähän teille pohjustukseksi. Eli pensasmustikan enempi niin kuin ammattimainen viljely alkoi Suomessa noin 2000-luvun alussa ja hyvin pitkään viljelypinta-ala on pysytellyt aika samoissa lukemissa, eli noin 80-85 hehtaaria suurin piirtein, mutta että parin viimeisten vuoden aikana niin kiinnostus pensasmustikan viljelyyn on ihan selvästi lisääntynyt ja viljelyalakin on tullut lisää tässä parissa vuodessa noin kymmenkunta hehtaaria. Eli tällä hetkellä pensasmustikkaa viljellään noin 94 hehtaarin alalla ja tästä noin hehtaarin verran on jo viljelyä. Myös kysyntä on ihan se.
Minna, nyt sun ääni katosi kokonaan. Kuuluuko Minna?
Ei kuulu Minnan ääntä muille.
Nyt kuuluu. Joo, se varmaan tässä. Eli ei mitään, jatkemme. Nyt ilmeisesti kuuluu hyvin.
Kuuluu.
Hyvä. Ei näy esityskin katosi jostain saman tien, niin jaa taas uudestaan pieni hetki, niin tosta jatketaan nyt noin. Nyt pitäisi näkyä.
Joo, näkyy.
Jep, hyvä. Eli sitten jo tosiaan jatketaan. Eli tässä on tosiaan näitä pensasmustikan tuotantolukuja vähän Suomesta. Eli en tiedä nyt mihin kohtaan jäätiin, mutta tällä hetkellä noin 94 hehtaaria on viljelypinta-alaa ja hehtaarin verran tunneleissa. Ja tuonti on aika suurta ja keskittyy nimenomaan kesäkuukausille ja kesä-heinä-elokuun ajalle. Ja tarkoittaa ihan sitä, että kyllä tästä tuonnistakin niin kuin iso osa voitaisiin kyllä kotimaisilla tuotannollakin sitten korvata. Eli pensasmustikka siis kiinnostaa ja siitä osoituksena on myös tämä webinaari tänään. Eli tähänkin webinaarin ennakkoon ilmoittautui yli 90 osallistujaa, mikä on aivan älyttömän hieno luku, eli ylittää kyllä moninkertaisesti meidän tavoitteet tälle päivälle, joten iso kiitos myös kaikille teille mielenkiinnosta pensasmustikkaa kohtaan. Ja toivon, että webinaari on teille kaikille erittäin antoisa, ja ja tota, nyt vielä ennen kuin päästään Eijan ääneen seuraavaksi, niin ihan muutama sananen tästä webinaarista.
Hengittää tämän eli, sormen,
no niin,
jonka jo kaunista.
Joo, jollain taas mikki päällä, eli ensinnäkin... Nyt varmaan kuuluu taas ääni. No niin, nyt taas palattiin tänne takaisin. Eli jostain syystä ne ääni välillä häviää, mutta ja tota, esitystä ei tarvitse enää näyttää, mutta tota, tosiaan muutama yleinen sana tähän webinaarin kulkuun tähän loppuun. Eli tota, tosiaan toivotaan, että pidätte kamerat ja mikit suljettuina webinaarin ajan ja toivotaan myös erittäin runsaasti kysymyksiä tämän webinaarin aikana, eli niitä voitte lähettää tämän chattitoiminnon kautta, eli tuosta yläpalkista löytyy tämmöinen puhekupla, missä lukee, että tota, näytä keskustelu, niin sieltä klikkaamalla niin voitte kirjoittaa kommentteja ja kysymyksiä tosiaan meidän päivän esiintyjille. Ja me niitä sitten tota, Eijan kanssa täältä sitten jokaisen esityksen lopuksi niin sitten tota, esitetään ja voitte kirjoittaa niitä englanniksi tai suomeksi, että ei ole mitään väliä. Ja tosiaan esitykset pidetään englanniksi, ja, mutta tota, tästä webinaarista tullaan tosiaan kirjoittamaan artikkeli suomeksi myöhemmin, eli pääsette sitä vielä sitten kertaamaan sitä kautta ja tämä webinaari myös tallennetaan, eli tota, huomioittehan sen tosiaan sit myös, että se tulee sitten ihan kaikille julkiseksi YouTube-tallenteeksi myöhemmin, ja tämä linkki tallennetaan myös Laatumaare-hankkeen kotisivuille, eli proagria.fi kautta Laatumaare, niin sieltä sitten myöhemmin pääsee tämän tallenteen uudestaan sitten katselemaan ja kuuntelemaan. Ja tota, sen verran mainostan vielä, että jos ette ole vielä liittyneet mukaan, niin Laatumaare-hankkeen avoin Facebook-ryhmä toimii, ja sinne mahtuu vielä väkeä mukaan, eli se tosiaan löytyy Laatumaare-hanke nimellä Facebookista, eli sinne kannattaa sitten käydä liittymässä, jos Marjan tuotannon asiat kiinnostaa sitten enemmän. Mutta tota, oikeastaan mulla ei nyt tähän alkuun pienistä tota, tämmöisistä ongelmista tai riippumatta, niin tota, on muuta sanottavaa, että mä siirrän nyt puheenvuoron Eijalle, ja Eija sitten tosiaan esittelee vähän meidän päivän ohjelmaa ja esiintyjä enemmän. Eli ole hyvä, Eija.
Jes, eli moikka kaikille. Eija Lankinen Kekkilästä, jos ette vielä tunne. Ja tosiaan kiitos kaikille, ketkä on tähän nyt osallistunut mukaan. Ollaan kyllä todella hämmentyneitä tästä osallistujamäärästä, että mä ajattelin, että jos 30 tulee, niin on hyvä suoritus, mutta ollaan tosiaan moninkertaisesti ylitetty se lukema. Elikkä tämähän nyt lähdettiin järjestämään siksi, että meidän piti järjestää semmoinen reissu tuonne tota, Hollantiin, mutta valitettavasti se sitten peruuntui. Mutta tota, nyt sitten tehdään tämmöinen webinaari siitä hyvästä. Eli tämän aloittaa tämän meidän ohjelman niin mun kollegani Bart Verhaajen, joka on siis Kekkilä BVBn edustaja, ja hän on todella pätevä ammattilainen pehmusmustikan suhteen, hän kertoo kasvualustoista. Seuraavaksi meillä on sitten toi Folkrig, he ovat niin kuin maailmanlaajuinen tämmöinen pehmusmustikan sekä taimituottaja että myöskin viljelijä ja jalostaja. Sitten Folkrigin jälkeen meillä on sitten nähdään mun toinen kollegaani Erik Boot tulee kertomaan tota lannoituksesta, ja viimeisenä meillä on sitten Sviri-Verkesin taimiston edustaja sitten kertomassa myös heidän valikoimastaan tänne Suomen markkinoille. Elikkä näin, nyt mä voin, okei, okay, then Bart, you are the first one, and after Bart, then there will be Folkrig presentation. So Bart, can you hear me and you can start if possible your show.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Hopefully you can see me. Thank you, Mina and Aya. Just to make sure that everything works well, I will share my presentation. I will put my camera off. So just give me 1 second. Yes. Can you see my presentation, Aya?
Yes, we can okay. See it.
Perfect. I hope you all do well, and I'm very happy at least that I have the opportunity to explain more about blueberry substrate production. And my name is Bart Verhaajen, and I'm really excited to give a presentation. Please feel free to ask questions by the chat. Of course, it's always possible to do this in the Finnish language. Aya or Minna can translate your questions then. And thank you so much for participating in this digital conference. Unfortunately, it was not allowed to visit the Netherlands and visit our customers, but this gives us the best alternative at this point. And if the COVID situation will be better, I'm happy to show you our factories and the nurseries of our customers. For now, I'm glad that I have the opportunity to say something about blueberry substrates production up to now and how we see the new developments and new challenges regarding blueberry substrates production in the future. First of all, I will give just a short personal introduction. I was raised in the growing business, helping out at my family's tree nursery when I was a kid, and I started my career at BVB Substrates during my bachelor studies, where I was working in the production facilities. And later, during my master studies, started working in the sales office and product management. Today, I'm the product manager for the soft fruit sector at Kakila BVB, and I'm based in the south part of the Netherlands, where basically all the Dutch blueberry growers are based. I aim to work together with customers and stakeholders to create a future where the soft fruit sector is able to be profitable in a sustainable way. And it's really my vision that sustainable growing solutions are developed together. And this is what I will explain further in my presentation, how we see the future in terms of blueberry substrate production. The agenda for today, hopefully you can see it, Aya. The agenda is today I will start with a short introduction about the company, followed by the technical topics for growing blueberries in open soil, followed by the blueberry cultivation innovation, the sustainability in the raw materials which we use for our blueberry composition and blends, and followed by the new alternative raw materials and our sustainability roadmap. I will end the presentation with my conclusions. In 2019, Kakila and BVB started a joint venture. The reason why we have started the joint venture is because of several reasons, such as the long-term vision and the market developments, like a lot of worldwide cooperations and expansions, but also think on the availability of raw materials to fill in these expansions and the issue regarding the circular economy. Because of the cooperation, we are having more capacity for our research and development, and this is a very important value for BVB Substrates and Kakila, because there is a lot of pressure regarding sustainability and regarding the sustainable substrates in the future. Kakila BVB has 12 production locations, and we supply our substrates to 100 plus countries every year. As you can see, we have different brands in the market. So we have Hasselforce, for example, BVB, Kakila Garden, Kakila Professional, Jardino, Veenbaas, and Kakila BVB. For example, BVB Substrates is a family company from the Netherlands, founded in 1908 already, and is the leading company in substrates industry. Only the BVB Substrates brand has more than 300 employees worldwide, and our focus is on sustainability and innovation. Kakila BVB produces every year high quality substrate for different markets like soft fruits, horticulture, mushroom, consumer and landscaping. If we go to the next slide, to the timeline, all our recipes are tailored to our customer grower needs. And as you can see in this timeline, we started our first BVB research in 1987. And in the meantime, we have two professional facilities for research and development in the Netherlands. And our research goals are chemical, physical, and biological investigation, but also the quality control and supply chain control. We are strongly focused on research for new alternative raw materials and innovation for sustainable growing. Besides, we already started very early to optimize our substrate plans for the blueberry industry. BVB was the first company who started a constantly optimize their blueberry brands, not only for production in pots, but also for in the open soil. Kakila BVB is the European leading company for professional growers in different markets, with a total turnover above 250 million euros. The state of the art of research and development, so that means that we are constantly improving our research and development and looking for new raw materials. The deep knowledge and best offering of different growing media, materials and products. Security of supply through extensive own raw material resources And like I said, we want to ensure our raw materials for the future. We want to meet the needs of our customers and our customers expanding, and there is more need of reliable substrates. The ability to make a difference together with you. We want to work together with our customers and stakeholders, and this I will explain further in my presentation. Kekkila BVB is one company, but there are still two brands in the market. So the BVB substrate brand, which is more suitable for the high quality blends, and the Kekkila brand, which is more suitable and very strong for the more basic blends. And our core values are focus on customer success, achieving together, trust through respect, and courage to renew. Our mission is to deliver products that are perfectly matched to our customers' growing needs. So we achieve this through cooperation and knowledge exchange between our employees, customers, suppliers, and other stakeholders. The idea is to constantly challenge each other to arrive at the ideal and most sustainable solution. So this was only just a short introduction. This is more for now the technical topics regarding the blueberry open soil. I will go to the next slide, which is the Vaccinium corymbosum. So it's originally from peatland areas. It has a relatively shallow and fine root system. It doesn't like wet feet and likes well-drained soils. It requires a low pH for the best uptake of nutrients and is a sun-loving and acid-loving plant. So blueberries belong to the Vaccinium genus that also includes heather, for example, cranberries, wild blueberries, the pyrus, rhododendrons, etc. So this group of plants only develop well in acidic-rich soils, in organic material, and in regions with these soils. It is therefore essential to take certain aspects into account if you're considering growing blueberries on a commercial scale. Of course, we have the opportunity to grow blueberries in open soil or in containers, and there is still a lot of potential where we can grow blueberries. And first, I will start with growing blueberries in the open soil. If we are talking about growing blueberries in open soil, there are four crucial aspects. First of all, the water analysts always check your water quality before you start thinking about growing blueberries. The quality of the soil, the amount of white peat, and the well-drained soil. So the blueberry bushes forms a finely branched, compact, and fairly close to the surface root system. And to maintain good and continuous growth, the upper layer of soil must be sufficiently moist. Installing a drip irrigation system in the plantation is vital. The bushes performs best on nutrient-rich, well-draining soil that also has a sufficient water-holding capacity. It is also strongly recommended to create ridges in which the bushes are planted. In the first few years after planting, the ridges can be covered to reduce weed growth and prevent the upper soil layer from dehydrating. The distance between the rows should be between 2.5 and 3 meters, with a spacing distance between the bushes in the row of 60 to 100 centimeters. Then this converts to around 3,500 and 4,000 plants per hectare. However, we see a lot of new developments with higher density, for example. At this moment, the amount of plants will increase to around 5,000 plants per hectare. I'm 100% sure that Fall Creek and Schijnwerkers will tell more about this aspect. Before the bushes are planted in the field, the acidity and the organic matter content of the soil must be brought to the right levels by incorporated white peat fibers in the ridges created to accommodate the plants. The optimal soil pH value for blueberry bushes in open soil is between 4.5 and 5.5. And as very few soils naturally have this pH value, measures have to be taken to create the right level. As well as incorporating white peat fibers, irrigation water with a low pH value should be used. The amount that should be added fluctuates between 300 and 400 cubic of white peat per hectare, greatly depending, of course, on the results of the soil analysts. Now, this was an example of an open soil plantation what was set up this year in the Netherlands. Higher density with around 5,000 plants per hectare, and the grower adds 400 cubic of white peat fibers per hectare to create the right pH level and organic matter. We use around 10 centimeters of the open soil to mix it with our white peat, which exactly means that we have a composition of the ridges between 80 or 90% of white peat and only 10 or 20% of open soil. They use around 70 to 90 liter white peat per linear meter. So we have also tested this with adding new sustainable raw materials such as an acrecio and top clean to cover the planting holes, but I will explain this later in my presentation. Exactly 13 years ago, we have started a project to grow blueberries in containers. We have tested this in 20 till 35 liter pots, and B2B Substrates was the first supplier who started together with other stakeholders these tests. And the reason why we have started this innovation is because of the following aspects. So the reduction of water and fertilizer, so you can control your watering and fertilizer much more better in containers instead of the open soil. The efficiency per hectare, so you can grow more plants per hectare with high density planting. The knowledge about the best substrate quality for blueberries in containers. To learn about the test of the best quality substrate for blueberries and learn about the technical needs of a blueberry plant for the long-term cultivation. The possibilities to grow in areas what would otherwise be impossible. So think about heavy soils or rock soils. Higher yields per hectare, so you can have a better and faster root development in the beginning when the composition of the substrates is optimal and you can grow higher density instead of the open soil. The quicker return of investment, so one of the reasons there's a higher density because you can grow more plants on a hectare and so you can have a quicker return of investment. Innovation and new plant variety. Think also about frost resistance, climate zones, new planting methods, taste, quality, yield. This is also the reason why we still cooperate together in different breeding programs to learn about new variety needs. The requirements. As a substrate supplier, you always play a little bit with the right water retention capacity in the substrates in relation to the high to the right air content. So, and what were our most important requirements? So the air fill porosity and the PF curve, so that means the water uptake retention curve. Our goal was to have a substrate what was able to have an air content of 20% in the most wet conditions. So the water uptake characteristics, it was very important to have a fast water uptake because a critical requirement is never to let the substrates dry out. That's why we use, for example, coir and perlite in our mixes to set up a faster water uptake, but I will explain this later on in my presentation. Fertilizing pH and pH buffer of a substrates mix. So we always produce a blueberry blend with a pH level around 5. And we add always a start fertilizer in our substrates composition. So there is always in the beginning of the crop just a little bit available for the plant. And that means that the EC level of our substrates is always around a 0.5. Depending on the needs of our customers, there's also a possibility to add slow release fertilizers in our mixes. And we use this, for example, often for our Dutch customers. Stability. So if the mixture is stable enough for the long term, the amount of air content after irrigation is important to keep the conditions stable. And that's why it is important to use only stable raw materials. It is a long-term cultivation and our business plan was to grow in containers for at least 10 years in the same pot. So the stability of the raw materials is very important. And we have mentioned that you can only observe this after several years. So after the root system has been set, so the skeleton takes over a pot and therefore it's important to use only stable raw materials without accumulation of organic matter at the bottom of the container. So fertilizer should be applied in spring and summer, but my colleague Eric will explain much more about fertilizing in a blueberry cultivation. So all these technical requirements are extremely important to develop and optimize our best plants to grow blueberries in containers. So our goals of research into growing blueberries in containers, to have a stable growing media for the first 10 years after planting. And in the meantime, we have the experience of 13 years in the same pot. enabling a balanced moisture ratio, so no compacting as we can see in the top picture. No compacting, what you can see there is that we used different raw materials, only tested. So that means that we used pinus bark, we used pumice, we used different raw materials to set up, okay, what is then the best mixture what we can have. The right balance in air content and enable a more sustainable way of growing. And during these tests, we're constantly looking for the best solution, And we have used, so I said earlier, we have used different raw materials and different blends. So that means that we constantly optimize our blend, and this was based on a number of important requirements, as you can see in the next slide. So our substrates meant for the blueberry production are the results of many years of experience, trials and feedback from researchers, advisors and also growers, of course. And our blueberry mixtures consist of several raw materials and additives. So each raw material has a unique physical and chemical properties, which makes the application of each raw material, of course, also different. So a little bit more information about the raw materials for growing blueberries in containers in our experience. We always make a combination of 3 or 4 raw materials to meet the requirements of a blueberry. And in the most wet state of the cultivation, we always have a right air content, and this is crucial for growing blueberries on the long term in containers. And like I said, we always make a combination of different raw materials, and depending on the climate, we make different choices in the percentages of these raw materials. And in our tests, we constantly optimize our blueberry compositions, and we still make our choices depending on what are the grower needs, what are the circumstances regarding climate conditions, what is the water quality, and what is the way of watering, and so on and so on. So this is not only one blueberry composition and that's it. We look together with the grower for a composition or a blend, what is the best for the grower. So a little bit more information about our raw materials, and especially the sustainability of these raw materials as well. And first I will start with the white peat from Blox, which we use for the blueberry compositions and the blueberry blends. Kakila BVB target by 2024 is to use 80% peat, which is RPP certified. So this is a very clear certificate, which means responsibly produced peat. Peat can be harvested roughly from May till September, when the weather is warm and the surface of the bark dry is dry enough. So horticulture peat is extracted using 2 different methods to produce 2 types of peat, milled peat and block peat. We are going to peat lands what are already being used for purposes like agriculture and 3 nurseries. And afterwards, we actually want to bring these peat lands back to a better state, how we find them. White peat, also known as sphagnum peat, has a high water absorption capacity because it can absorb up 9 times its own weight. So for a long-term cultivation with high standard place on the air holding capacity and stability, like blueberries in containers, we will mainly be using peat extracted vertically, so-called block peat. And therefore you have a fewer dust particles and therefore a higher air holding capacity if you compare it, for example, with milled peat. A more stable character, so it reduced risk of settling or compaction, and it has a higher water absorption capacity than milled peat. It is drier and creates a stable structure in the mix. Peat is naturally acid and is therefore the ideal medium to grow blueberries. By adding white peat from blocks, you are having a coarser structure of the blend. Besides, you are having a higher pH buffer because peat has a much more higher pH buffer if you compare it, for example, with different raw materials like perlite or like coir. Depending on the circumstances, we are using between 25 and 40% in our blueberry blends. The second raw material is coir, also known as coir pit, and it's from the husk of the coconut. And it has the following properties. So this year we really target to use around 1.5 cubic water for one cubic coir. And normally you use between 3 and 5 cubic of water to use one cubic of coir. So this is a real improvement in my opinion. Cocoa, which is widely used in blueberry mixtures, and with cocoa we really want to reduce waste and especially water waste. Water is an incredibly scarce raw material and resources now in the world, and especially where cocoa is coming from, such as India and Sri Lanka, where there is an incredible water shortage and population often do not have access to clear water services. And if you think about this, that then it's really for us a clear topic that we want to buffer and want to proceed our coir in our own facilities. And that's the reason why we have different facilities in the Netherlands where we proceed our coir by ourselves, really to lowering our footprint of the coir, and that we also can show it to our retailers, for example. But I will explain that later. Coir is a high air content, what is quite unusual because it has a fine structure. It's a very rapid water absorption capacity and good capillary working. Depending on the circumstances, we are using between 30 and 50% in our blueberry mix. And in blueberry mixes, CocoPrete is used for the rapid rehydration from a dry state. So make sure you only use well-buffered and well-washed cocoa when you're compiling it to your recipe. Well-buffered cocoa ensures that the nutrients of the plants are well absorbed by the cocoa and released again when the plant needs them. So unbuffered cocoa of unbuffered coir will give an imbalance in cations. So this can cause imbalance of different cations such as potassium, sodium, calcium and magnesium. Buffering treatment is needed to take away the imbalance during the growth. The buffering treatment can be done with a calcium, and by washing the cocoa product, the amount of salt will reduce, so this will lower your EC level. The last raw material is perlite. Perlite is basically a volcanic rock, so it does not buffer any nutrients. It can contain high quantities of air and water. It ensures rapid water absorption and good distribution of moisture throughout the substrate. It contributes to be a stable structure of a mix. Perlite is mainly used in substrate mixtures for softwood to increase the air content of the growing medium and improve the water absorption capacity. Depending on the circumstances, we are using between 25 and 35% of perlite in our blueberry blends. We have tested a lot of raw materials and different combinations, but like I said, the best results in the pilot was a substrate based on a combination of black peat, cocoa and perlite. And while we'll make a combination of different raw materials, especially with black peat, we have a higher pH buffer. Because of the unique combination of different stable raw materials, you do not have problems with your fluctuation in your pH level, for example, and a stable pH level is crucial for the absorption of the nutrients, of course. So the combination with especially black peat gives a more stable pH buffer, and because of the combination of different raw materials, you have a right balance between water and air content. And this is crucial to grow blueberries for a long term in a pot. So these were really our technical topics of growing blueberries in containers. And yeah, we have developed it and optimized it constantly, our blends, what in our experience meets the requirements of a blueberry. And these blueberry blends has proven itself now for 13 years in the same pot. So, but like I said earlier in the presentation, we as a company, Kekkila BVB, need to renew and develop for the new market demands in the future. So 13 years ago, we have developed blueberry blends for growing blueberries in containers. But what are then the new developments in our opinion? And how do we see the future regarding substrates and regarding our blueberry substrates production? And this is really a direct link with the global sustainability issues. First, I will start with the complementary new raw materials. You already saw it probably in the presentation, the slide of Acrecio. So Acrecio is a high water retention and absorption rate. So it can retain as much as 25 times its own weight in water. The creation of air porosity in the growing media, which is beneficial for the plant roots. Acrecio is resistant to spreading of various fungi and diseases, and a regrowth rate less than 30 years. So we harvest every year 10 millimeters of this load. Acrecho has a small environmental footprint, and we already test a lot of Acrecho in our blueberry substrates. Again, you will join the presentation of Skymax and Fall Creek later today, and we have tested this at the nurseries, but also in the production pot, so that means in a 25 and 35 liter pot. And at this time, no compacting at all, and very good fruit production. A new product, Top Clean as well. So this is tested and completely safe to use, and it does not harm any crops. Moisture, water, and quick drying. It reduced the evaporation of water from the substrate. No waste. So BFB Top Clean forms a stable, solid top layer that is not blown away by wind or spilled during transportation or whatever. And it's easy to use for growing in containers as well as growing in open soil. For example, to cover the planting holes in the open soil if you work with plastic on the ridges. So these are really the new developments in new complementary raw materials. Acrecho has very nice characteristics with a high air content and a fast water uptake. And besides, the stability of this raw material is very good. So we have tested this on big scale to lower our footprint and having the same results as our blueberry blends we are used to work with. At this time, we have great results, and these are really the new developments for growing blueberries in containers in the most sustainable way. So in a way that we're constantly innovating and researching and seeing how we can move forward and can improve, we really want to help you achieve the goals you need to achieve. So this means also we do not judge or promote any raw material. It is our goal to make responsibly produced substrates together with our customer that actively contributes to the sustainability. And for example, one of our biggest market in the consumer is the consumer market, which means the retailers. We have organized, for example, knowledge fairs together with these retailers to discuss these issues and make them aware about footprints. And this is a trend that is expected to develop further to the growers, so also to our customers. The next slide is our sustainability roadmap. And I will show you, hopefully you can see it now. So I would like to say something about our vision, at least regarding sustainability, and how we as a company can add value regarding sustainability in the total blueberry industry. And this is and will be, in my opinion, a really important topic for us as an industry. So let's take a look what we have in mind in tackling sustainability for the future. And our main goal for Kakila BFB is that we want to become a net positive company where our operations do not have a negative impact on the environment, but have a positive impact on the environment. We try to do that to following the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which they have set up for 2030, which are actually 17 goals that the United Nations have set up for 2030 to really take care of the climate issues that are currently playing in the world. And of course, sustainability is a broad topic, and you heard it probably many, many times. And the key is really, I think, that you as a company, you have to find a way to fill in sustainability in your own way. So what does it mean for you? And for us, like I said, we want to become a net positive company, but we achieve this on four initiatives. And these initiatives are, as you can see, biodiversity and restoration. First of all, which means that you as a company that harvests raw materials, we want to focus on restoring the impact we have on nature after we are harvested our raw materials. So we also would like to create biodiversity within environments. And this really addresses one of the pillars of sustainability, which is ecological sustainability. The second target is flourishing people, focuses on the other pillar of sustainability, which is the social sustainability. And here we really want to focus on how we can take care of the people working within our offices and within our company, but also within our sector, the people who are working on the field, in the offices, and the people in our factories, of course. So how can we provide a safe and good work environment? The third part is green growth and recycling. And like the name says, it really focuses on a hot topic called circular economy and really addresses, again, not only ecological sustainability, but also economical sustainability in a way that we focus on transforming our economy from a linear economy to a circular economy, where we see that we would like to lower our footprints through recycling, through reusing, and through really having growth in our company in a sustainable way. And this also means a combination of using new innovative, but also new raw materials, which have a lower footprint with the best growing quality. And we are able to give customers, for example, footprints of the substrates which they are really using. The fourth part is sustainable food and living, and one that is very important. And in the world, we see a couple of mega trends, and one of them is we have a growing population. And with the growing population, we have less space to grow more food. So we have to grow more food with less space. So how do we do that? And how do we grow this food in a sustainable way? And this again addresses the ecological pillar here. So growing more with less. And like I said, this is our contribution, but we have to do that together. So the next slide, and hopefully you can see it, is the conclusion and the outlook for tomorrow, or at least for the future. We as a company, Kakula BVB, be the front runner in sustainability through our sustainability roadmap, leading to sustainable growing, responsible harvesting and sustainable production of raw materials, and a strong focus on innovation and sustainability lead to complementary raw materials with a low footprint. And our blueberry blends are tailor-made blends based on your needs. So the customer success is our most important core value. But like I said, and this is really the thing what I want you to take away from my presentation today, is that we have to do this together, and we achieve only the biggest results by working together. So here I am today in front of you, inviting you to work with us and to work also with us for a more sustainable future, and for a future in which we can grow blueberries in a profitable and sustainable way. So let's do that together, and because only together we can grow for a better future, in my opinion. Thank you for today, and if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them on the chat.
Okay, thank you. It looks like that, there's no questions at the chat. Does anyone have any questions now? It seems like not yet, but if any questions comes later, you can always write in the chat and we can ask them later on, of course, also. Folkrig has three different presentations about trends and market development, variety developments, and basic technical data. So is Ronnie out there already, or who will start?
I will start. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. I see there's a question, maybe that we can do that before. I think it's a question for Bart. I don't know.
The question is that it's about the Finnish situation. Is there any success about growing blueberries in pots? And I'm sure that Bart doesn't know about that, but I can answer that. I know there has been some growers that has been growing blueberries in pots in Finland also, but the problem is, of course, our winters. So if it's really cold, so it doesn't always, it's not possible always to succeed through the winter. But So yes, there has been some trials, but not very much, so it needs to be more tested. Okay, but then Seb, you can start.
All right, thank you. I want to start with Huva iltapäivä te kaikki. So good afternoon, and that was my only Finnish for today because I'm sorry I can't speak it. So thank you all again, like Bart also mentioned, for joining this webinar. My name is Seb Fesjes. I'm sales representative for Valkyrie in the Netherlands and some countries in Europe. I will start our Valkyrie presentations with a general information about Valkyrie, and my colleagues Ronnie Kersten will follow up with trends and developments and market developments, and Marius will do more technical presentation, also more focused on Finland itself. I hope you can see my screen. If not, I will continue. Perfect. So I'm starting with who is Valkyrie. Just before, I want to show you a quick company video, which is really interesting. So enjoy. Okay, I understood that there is no voice for you, no sound. So I will continue with the presentation. I'm sorry, and I share my screen again. All right. So who is Valkyrie? Valkyrie is founded in 1978 by Dave and Barbara Brazelton in the US. It's a family-owned company. At this moment, we have the second generation active. Cort and Amelie Brazelton are now the co-CEOs. Dave is now in the board of directors. We have more than 150 hectares of nursery in production. So that's quite a lot, where we produce over 40 million of blueberry plants per year globally. We have a wholly owned facilities in the United States, where we have three farms in Mexico, Peru, Spain, the Netherlands, and South Africa. We have nurseries at this moment, and we are really investing and looking into Asia to see what the possibilities are there. At this moment, we have worldwide more than 500 team members, so we are a big team with a lot of knowledge, in our opinion. Those are the two hippies, Dave and Barbara Brazelton. They are the founders of the company. On the right, Dave, on the left, Barbara. And at this moment, we have the Brazelton and Oz family. This is the second generation. On the left, Cort Brazelton with his wife and children. In the middle, Dave and Barbara, the founders. On the right, Boris and Amelie, which are Amelie's also co-CEO, and Boris is our financial chief. A little bit about the structure of Valkyrie. So we are owned by shareholders, which falls under board of directors. They steer on the co-CEOs, Cord and Amelie, and we have a president, Oscar Verges, who is based in the United States also. They all lead our executive team, and those are all facilities in globally, so all our nurseries and facilities. As you can see, a picture of our global leadership team. So we have a lot of people who are leading a group of people and leading the whole company, which is quite nice, and which gives a boost to the whole structure and the nurseries. a slide may be old-fashioned, but in our opinion, it's really important to show our vision and our mission to everybody. As it says here, cultivating exceptional plants, relationships, and innovative solutions to optimize customer success. So quickly said, if you don't have success as a grower, as a customer of us, then where are we? Where is our success? So that really matters. As we also say, we want to create a world with better blueberries in the end. Our company is based on three pillars. Those are genetics, plants, and support. I will go into the all three more specific now. First of all, genetics and also intellectual property. As you can see, we have from germplasm, private breeding programs and partner breeding programs. We do trialing and applied research and our IP management, intellectual property management. Germplasm, so we have our own in-house germplasm. Our mother plants, or mother lines, are based in Oregon in the United States. We work together with, we have our own Fall Creek private breeding program, where we have no low, mid, and high chill varieties in. For Finland, we will focus mainly on the high chill varieties, as Marius will explain later more. We also work together with partner programs, so they are public and private, like public, like universities, like Michigan State or Florida University. What else? Trialing and applied research, where we investing heavily in, because it's really important that we do trialing in our new genetics and new selections, and the applied research in it, of course. And we have our own in-house legal team where they are really focusing and try to keep our intellectual property manageable. And we have, as you can see, the license of more than 100 varieties in 40 plus jurisdictions, so in the whole world globally. Second, plants, which is, of course, one of the most important thing we do. We serve our growers plants. So what we try to focus on is a clean plant growing system. So we really don't want that there are any health issues or diseases coming into our nurseries or into our plants, which spread in the world, which is really bad. So we are trying to keep everything very clean, of course. We also try to manage that by our global tissue culture supply chain. So as I've told you, we have our mother plants based in Oregon, where we do our propagation also. And we send, for example, when we are serving Finland, then we will serve mostly plants from the Netherlands, as we are growing there mostly high chill varieties. We will have our plants coming from Spain. From Spain, they will serve us with little plugs, and we put them in bigger pots and grow them when they are around 2 years old. Hardening and climatization is more that we have everything in greenhouses, where we shear the plants often during the year. We really want to let the plant focus on growth and on root development, so that you as a grower in the end get a good quality plant. And we have comprehensive global nursery network. As I told, we are really working together with all our nurseries all over the world. Third is, which is also really important in our opinion, grower support. We have a global team of technical experts, people around the world, focusing only on grower support. So giving support to the grower in the fields. So what is that support? It's mostly pre-plant execution planning, huh? As people don't know or are doubting about varieties which to plant. they really help you with how you can measure the field, how many plants do you need, how many. Also, we speak a lot, of course, with BVB, Kekila, for planning how many peat they need in the fields and so on. Establishment and ongoing consulting. So if you have questions, you can always ask and discuss with these grow supports about varieties or whatever, issues, diseases, etc. Variety specific management. So we, Marius will continue about that also for Finland, to really show you which varieties are suitable for your environment. And troubleshooting, if there is something wrong, they do troubleshooting. Quickly, Fall Creek, where are we? Like I've told, in Oregon, we are based with three farms, I should say. Mexico, Peru, then we headed over to Europe, to the south of Spain, around Sevilla. And in 2018, we took over a Dutch nursery called Driesvenplant. So there we have Fall Creek Driesvenplant, where I am based, where Ronnie is based. And in the south, we have Fall Creek South Africa, a new nursery. And I told you, we are investing in Asia. Quickly, some pictures about our nurseries, which is really nice, in my opinion, to show you. This is our main offices, our head building in Oregon, and our nursery. You can see we are growing everything on container fields or in under tunnels, under greenhouses. This is the second farm we have in Oregon, in the United States. And third, we have Pleasant Hill. Later on, we went to Jalisco in Mexico. And this is our nursery in Cañete in Peru. Our nursery in Sevilla in Spain. And last, a picture of our 14-hectare nursery in Metrik in Holland around Venlo, close to BVB, by the way. Now I'm focusing a little bit more about our two licensing strategies we have as a Fall Creek. So we have an open catalog and we have Fall Creek Collection, which is new. Open catalog, where we have varieties in of all chill levels, so no low and mid and high chill varieties. Those varieties are available for everybody, so it's easily to access. There are no access fees. Just some royalties in it, depends on the breeding program they are, and easily attainable order minimums. So we can ship also small quantities of plants from the open catalog. The second is Fall Creek Collection, which is really it's not an exclusive program. It's more a semi-exclusive program. Is also easily attainable if you meet the minimum qualification criteria, which give no limits to this membership, and it's really a license to grow. So you can buy license for varieties and grow better high performance genetics at also at all chill levels. So one slide more about the open catalog. A selection of varieties which we think are the characteristics are equal or better versus existing commercial varieties. So the varieties which are already for 40, 50 years around the world on the market. These selection also include our own Fall Creek genetics, like Top Shelf, Blue Ribbon, High Chill varieties, but also the university genetics, the private genetics, as open varieties. And the open varieties examples, maybe you know them, Ventura, Mezelis May, or Duke. The criteria for customers is there are really none. They are available to everybody. You can buy them, you can order them, and speak with our, and you can get already the grow support of us, which is really nice. I need to add that the varieties are protected and they need to be protected in your region. They need to be on the national list. But for Finland, I assume it will be no problem. Second, the Fall Creek Collection model. It's really an added value genetics delivery platform. So we try to include our technology, our knowledge about varieties, and transfer this to our in our support, in our grow support, horticultural support for you as a commercial professional blueberry grower or over the world. Sorry. So what we really want you as a grower to give you the benefit and also be able to sell and serve the market with high quality fruit and secure a nice position in the market with constantly better varieties, as we are constantly investing in this program with the licensing money. Third, the terms of the program are simple and straightforward. You need to meet those minimum qualification requirements, which are you need to be a professional commercial grower, or you need to have experience growing and delivering quality fruit. As a nice professional grower of tomatoes can also step into this program. And you need to have demonstrated the history of IP compliance. So we don't want anybody to breed or to propagate with our varieties. And fourth, important also, you need to have a plan of at least 25 hectares of fall quick collection of those varieties in a reasonable period, and not in 5 years, but a reasonable period for everybody. But we do all of this in discussion together with the grower. Quickly, the four varieties which are on Heitje level in this fall quick collection program, they're all new. So some of them don't have any names. The name are pending. It takes also a really long period to get the patent for a name. So we have an early variety which is called FC14062. We have a early mid variety which is called Peachy Blue. It has already a name because it's a little bit earlier released in the market. And we have a mid-late and a late variety. The mid-late is FC11118. And we have a late variety, Luna Blue. And those are the varieties which are in the program. And if you have more questions or you want to know more, get to know more about these varieties, you can always ask to our big team. And we're happy to have questions. So, Ronnie, I want you to take over. If you have questions, my name was Seb Fesjes and is still Seb Fesjes. And you can ask me always your questions. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you. There's one question, should we take it now in the chat?
Yes. Yes, I saw a question relating to availability of Duke and Spartan. I'm not going too much in detail now because one of the things we try to present today to the audience is how important it is to make the right variety choice. And regarding to Spartan, it's a good example, which is a really old variety, and it's a variety we are not producing anymore due to the quality aspects. So let me first start with my presentation regarding market development and trends during the COVID crisis. After that, we will present some more variety information, and I think then it's a time to talk about more in depth regarding the varieties. Let me see. Can everybody see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so my name is Ronnie Kersten. I'm one of the key account managers for Fall Creek. I'm working from the Netherlands, as Seb already explained. Fall Creek has bought this nursery 2.5 years ago. On that moment, it was called Dries van Plant. So since 2.5 years, we are joining Fall Creek in their global nursery operations. I'm the key account manager for Fall Creek, so I'm managing mainly some bigger accounts in Europe. My history in blueberries is a little bit similar to what Bart was presenting this morning. I also started in 2008 with the research of substrate development. And since 2012, I was involved in the developing the international business for other substrate supplier. And since 2016, I'm in the nursery business. So that's a little bit of background for me. I'm 39 years old, although you wouldn't say that, of course. So yeah, thank you. So what we see in general during this crisis is we see an increase of global demand for blueberries, and it's mainly quality driven. It's a development that really came this year because in the past it was mostly price driven. If we look at the interest of blueberries on Google, which is a nice trend to follow, you can see the yellow line. There you can see the interest in blueberries on Google from the last 4 years. So yellow is the line of 2020. So we really see an increase of the interest of watching on Google. This is a statement that's coming from a retailer in Italy. We as a breeder and nursery company are already talking about crunchy and crunchiness of the fruit already for many years. But now the crunch is really more recognized in the market and used on food labels. And this is one example in Italy. Croccante is the main attribute mentioned on food labels sold in Italy. This is produced and published by Nielsen. Crunchy is becoming very important purchase criteria and the positive characteristics of the blueberry. So future will be much more focused on crunchiness and firmness of the fruit. If we look at retail reaction on product price and volumes, we saw globally an increase in retail pricing. Also, you saw that the average price during our northern season was much more stable this year compared to other years. Of course, there are also many challenges during this crisis. Huh? Everybody's working from home. A lot of purchase is done by internet, online shopping. So there are a lot of challenges for the retailers as well. The biggest challenges are the supply chain. So from the bush till the shelf, and the insufficient inventory. So that also involves the supply chain. To do this online shopping, it's only possible when the quality of the fruit is 100%. And that's in the end all related to the variety and to the performance of the grower and the cold chain itself. So if we look at the basic conditions for blueberry sales, from a consumer point of view, how can we stimulate blueberry consumption? Of course, the fruit must be good looking, nice shape, nice bloom, no moisture, no rotten fruit. And of course, availability in the shop. In the past, and I think it was even 4 years ago, we didn't have year-round blueberries in the shop. Today, you find nice presentation of all kinds of soft fruits in the shop. So this also will increase the blueberry consumption. And blueberries may not be sour, so we say excellent taste, and not be soft. Because if a consumer has a negative experience today, he will not buy blueberries for the next 10 weeks. That's proven. So that also means that it's a high impact if a grower is having a negative experience, which basically means that our season in Northern Europe, so in Finland, is over. What we also saw is a lower shopper frequency and but higher ticket value, sales in bulk. So the trend seems to be that people are buying longer life fruit, so blueberries over strawberries. So blueberries is no problem to keep them for 2 weeks in the cold storage or in your cooling at home. This is stated by the UK retailer. And what we also see is that in the supermarkets, the formats became bigger. So traditionally, in the past, we had 125, 150 grams packagings, but we really see in Central Europe that the size of the packaging is increasing, which also stimulates the consumption. Lower availability of qualitative, read firm, blueberries, and higher prices. So if you look at the Spanish season, which is normally not the best season, even in Spain, they had 12% higher prices than in 2019, which is a lot. This is one of the first years that the Spanish growers have made money again. And on average, the retail consumer prices were with a price between 12 and 24 euros and also higher compared to last year. So that's what I stated before. The average price during the whole season was higher and more stable than over the last few years. And if you look at Germany, for example, the blueberry category has grown over 38% in value. This was coming from Rewe. COVID-19 has also speeded up the organic demand. We see already for the last couple of years that there is a demand coming and increasing for organic, but even due to the COVID, it went even faster. So organic sales was already growing before 19, and during COVID, this trend was speed up. In Germany, the demand for organic was higher than the availability, and organic had a demand growth of 52% during the crisis. Of course, it also gave new opportunities to create new players with the same requirements. As COVID-19 is a global pandemic, will likely be one of the defining events of 2020, which changed the shopper behavior in bulk behavior buying and our online shopping. So we really saw a boost in online shopping. Online shopping had the growth between 200 and 400%, depending on the country. And it's really quality driven. So fresh and fruit and blueberries in online sales have to be equal or better versus traditional sales in the supermarket. Therefore, fresh players are looking for qualitative, tasteful, and firm blueberry genetics, also to control the whole supply chain and to have, in the end, happy consumers. Conclusions. What we see during the crisis and still is, it will not slow down the growth of blueberries. It's the contrary. It will increase the consumption until now. Shelf life and quality, firmness, taste, will be even more crucial criteria than before the crisis and will drive the variety selection. So we will see that variety selection becomes much more important. And we already see today that many retailers into Europe are already rejecting old varieties and focus much more on the newer genetics. If you look at blueberry consumption before and during the COVID, we stated a couple of years ago that we estimated that the European consumption in 5 to 7 years should grow to 750,000 tons. In 2019, this was almost 200,000 tons. What you see, what is happening, what can happen in 1 year in UK, the penetration went up with 5%. But even more interesting, the consumption in UK went up from 860 grams to 1.4 kilo. So it's the consumption which increased, but also the penetration. And what we see an annual increase of consumption in Europe of 23%. What we believe, if we look at the global picture, we have done our exercise, it took us 40, 50 years to reach a volume of 1 million ton consumption, which we had in 2019. And we believe it takes only 7 till 10 years to double this consumption globally. So we expect before 2030, we all consume 2 million tons globally. If we look at the European and North Africa fruit consumption, the fresh produce retail increased over 30% year on year in the UK, while frozen fruits and vegetables increased 100%. What I looked into the Netherlands, the consumption increased by 91%. And even more interesting to know is that the penetration went up from 23% till 45%. So again, it's penetration and it's consumption. if we look at parameters in the quality, that is how do we define quality of blueberries, and what does involve fruit quality? Of course, it's about variety. Secondly, it is about the plant quality, the plant you buy from the nursery. Of course, the grower, the agronomy is really important. Harvesting date, and then in the end, the cooling and the cool chain. This all involves quality of fruit. What I want to show here is how fast can consumption grow. That's what I stated before. In 2017, penetration UK was 45%, and the consumption was almost 840 grams. In 2018, penetration went up with 5%, which is a lot, but the consumption went even up to 1.4 kilos. So that's a 66.5% increase in consumption. This is can really happen in 1 year. And why do I put this on the screen? Because in UK, it's really a quality-driven market. They have really this high-tier segment in the retail. So what will be the future? Will it be price-driven? How do we get from price-driven to quality-driven? What are the real competitors of blueberries or fresh-cut fruit? Is it an apple? No, we don't think it's an apple. Do we think it's strawberries? We also don't think it's strawberries. We really believe that the competitors of today are the Lay's and the Snickers. What do we believe that drives the consumption in a market with low penetration? And in Europe, we are still, let's say, in a low penetration market. We talk about good taste, cheap price, good looking fruit, attractive packaging and presenting in the shop. But what shows in the research was that on number one, it was good looking fruit, which is drive the consumption. Secondly, it was attractive packaging and how the fruit is presented in the shop. The third thing was good taste, because good taste will stimulate the repurchase. And surprisingly, the cheap price was on the fourth place. So also here you can see there is still room for good quality product and to stimulate consumption. What is the secret of Lay's and Twix? In the end, it's 100% perfection and constant quality along the supply chain. So if you buy a Twix in Finland or you buy it in Germany, it will everywhere, it will be the same. So if a consumer has a negative experience, so when you buy blueberries today and you have a negative experience, 32% will walk away from a brand. And even more problematic is the repurchase can take 10 weeks. But this means that your season in Finland is over. To give a bigger perspective, with one truck of blueberries, so let's say 20 tons of blueberries with an average packaging of 125 grams, we reach 150,000 consumers, which means if you supply one truck with, let's say, bad or less quality fruit, and you reach 150,000 consumers which have a negative experience, it can destroy the whole season. So this is just to make you aware how important the quality decision is, and it has a really big impact on the market. This is what we call the quality index. Like I explained before, if you look at the quality index of Twix and Lay's, it's always perfect from the through the whole supply chain. And for blueberries, you see the risk pattern. These are all the aspects which can influence the quality of the fruit. What we see in Europe as a trend is buy local, think local, so produce local. We really see demand for local produce is increasing. So local for local will drive the growth. We expect in 2024, with the information we have today, that in Central Europe, and as you can see, Finland is just above, but in Central Europe, we expect an undersupply with the hectares planted today. So we really expect an undersupply, and we need to fill that gap. How to win? So how to focus with local production on varieties? It's all about the flavor of the fruit. It's about firmness, and in the end it's about size. And we have to act local, and that's a trend what you see in the market. Why? Because these markets are demanding local top quality products and value for money produced oversupply from Eastern Europe. And what I mean with this is, and I give you an example, in Serbia, it's a good example, 99% of the varieties planted today is only Juke. So what they have done, or they are doing, is creating their own problem of having one variety in one country and having an oversupply within a few years in that window. And the same happened in Spain a couple of years ago. There are 2-3 million plants of Ventura, which is just one variety planted in Spain. And what they have created as an industry is an oversupply in the Spanish season due to planting one single variety. This is the Highchill overview. Marius will explain a little bit more in depth, but these are the most planted varieties today. This will also be in the, how do you say it? We will send the presentation afterwards where you can review this this overview. This overview is based on blind tasting sessions that we do with customers through the whole year. So you can evaluate this data later as well. And I want to end with a very clear mission. Our mission is to build a world with better blueberries through exceptional plants, relationship, innovation, and in the end, customer success. Why are we doing this kind of events, webinars? It's to share knowledge, share information, and in the end, to support the growers. Secondly, what we do is we invite, organize field and forum days in Spain and in Holland. So in Holland, you can see all the new varieties and upcoming selections. You can taste the new fruit, compare between each other. And most important for you guys as, let's say, relatively new growers, in December every year, we organize technical events. So our grow supports are leading this and really share how to grow blueberries and where you have to take care of. So I want to end with that mission. This is these are my contact details for people who have any questions regarding market development. Just reach out to me. I don't know if there are any questions.
No questions at the chat.
Wow, so I was really good.
Yes, you were great.
So I give the floor to my dear friend Marius Podowski.
Yes.
Marius?
Yes, can Marius hear us? His microphone is open, but at least I don't hear anything.
I will check with him, 1 second.
Okay, thanks.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Good.
All right.
Yeah.
I changed the moving set. Okay. Very quick. And you can see my screen.
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay. Can you see my screen now?
Still no. We'll wait for a bit.
Okay, I'm shared the screen already. That means I.
Okay.
Still not.
No.
Okay. I'll try again. And now?
Well, still nothing. It might take a while, but. Still nothing.
Okay, let's wait a moment. because on my screen is showing that I'm sharing. That means I hope.
Yeah. Okay.
Still not?
Maris, I can share it as well if you want.
Okay, maybe try you from your end. Yeah.
Okay, we'll do that. So.
You guys can see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, Maris, I give the floor to you.
Okay, but I don't know why I can't see your screen. Maybe I switch off camera. Okay, I don't know why I can't see the screen. Ronnie, I can't see your screen. I don't know. I see all the faces and all the people, but no screen.
Strange.
Okay, yes. That is strange. I don't know either what could
maybe,
be the issue.
Maybe you can log out and enter the meeting again, Marius. Maybe that's the best.
Okay, I try to do that. Sorry about that. I'm doing that now.
Yeah.
So maybe somebody can sing a Finnish song or something.
Maybe. You can ask, but yeah, I think it's going to be a quite silent song.
That's always with the technology, right? If something is not working, it's not ideal, but
yeah,
we're working on it.
Yeah, these things happen. So, but funny because obviously he could see every other presentation until now, and now nothing works. But we'll see in a minute. So
okay, I'm back.
Welcome back. Can you see it?
Yes, I can see it also on his screen now. Yes, Ronnie, okay. Could you use your buttons to move further? That in. Welcome everyone. Sorry about the trouble. What I did, and I maybe first introduce myself. I am the growth support for Falkirk for most of the countries in Europe, special on the east, north, and also Turkey. Working with Falkirk over 2 years, but previously I was Sofruit advisor for major independent advisory company in Europe, based in Holland and also in UK. And I work for 12 years in UK with different crops of Sofruits like strawberries, blueberries, raspberries, and blackberries. Ronnie, could you move presentation, please? And you have to use the buttons. That means what I did a lot data, climatic data check for Finland. As you know, I'm from Poland. That means also we have quite cold weather conditions. And to be fair, this weather condition, what you have now, we have about, let's say, 10 years ago and not anymore. And what I check the climate mostly for the south of Finland, mainly for Helsinki area and Turku. I hope I'm saying properly. That means all this region, Ronnie, could you put the button again? That means in this region, I mostly check the climatic data, and I check climatic data because I want to see what varieties successfully we can grow in Finland, because not every variety can be grown in your country. Ronnie, please.
Marius, I give you access so you can move the screen now.
Okay. Okay. Then you can see I check climatic data, very detailed climatic data for Turku. That was my first what I trying to look on the west of southwest of Finland. I check the climatic data for full year in 2019, very detailed hour by hour on every day, on every month during the year. This was the graph what I came with average temperatures per each month. And what I did, I the same did for Helsinki. And I did another one for the more north part of Finland, but I concentrate first on the south of Finland. What I find out, I put the data during week by week in 2019, and you can see week by week working. I checked the growing degree hours. Growing degree hours is something where the plants are growing. That means it's growing season, and we can put the numbers how quick in each week the plant can grow. I check your chill units, chill hours actually below 7. Obviously, I check the minimum and maximum temperatures for the region on the south of Finland. What I did and what I come back with based on 2019, I check your first chill units, because obviously by chill we define which varieties we can grow or and which varieties will not perform well. That means we can easily find that you have more than 4,000 growing chill units below 7 in Finland. That means the more to the north, the more these chill units you will have. And what we find out also, that your chill units starting already in September and finish kind of beginning of May. That means this is quite long winter for most of the plants grow, especially soft fruits. Then as a rule in your country, especially in this climate, you can grow only high chill varieties, and you have to be careful when you're choosing varieties, because a lot of nurseries can have open varieties, and not all of them will perform well in your country. Then we also find that late varieties like Last Call, Aurora, and even Elliot can need to be grown under the tunnels to at least make sure you can harvest, because it's not enough season for you to harvest some late varieties. And why is that? I also work out with growing degree hours. Growing degree hours is nothing like where the plant is growing and how it's performing. The amount of growing degree hours per year can give us information which varieties in your climate we can harvest fully. Then what I check, in total per season, you can have 41,500 growing degrees. That was in 2019. We're talking about open field. But if the growing hours are really from May to September. That means even when we have 2,000 or nearly 3,000 growing degree hours in April, that really plant development will not be huge, because you still have quite a lot of chill in the same time. That means really your growing season is roughly 4.5 to 5 months maximum. When we see that means we can see the rapid growth, especially for blueberry plants, will start in May, and we can see slowing down, especially in the second part of September, with the cooler condition and with a lot of chill hours already. Then we can consider varieties what we can harvest in 37,000 growing degree hours. That means late variety, just to let you know, I put a little table on the bottom, a bit too much. I put on the bottom like Aurora, and it's 60,000 growing degree hours to make sure we can harvest the crop. And if you're looking in this case of your growing degree hours, it's not enough time to harvest these fruits. That you have to be very careful what varieties you're choosing to make sure you can harvest. Obviously, when you grow into tunnels, like you're growing raspberries or strawberries in Finland, then obviously you can stretch the season, can wider the season, and obviously you can put more growing degree hours under the tunnels, and you can grow some varieties what are struggle to grow on the open field, like, for example, Liberty or maybe even Last Call. What we can see now under the protection tunnels, this how can look your season. That means with varieties here, please don't consider drapery yet in your country, because with the quite cold September and already quite cold October, the drapery is more mid-chill varieties than high-chill varieties, but you can grow under the tunnels. And I can tell you before climate get a bit hotter, much hotter now, we also not grow draper in Poland because of the cold weather conditions and not been successful. Draper already is 19 years old variety, and we can say that only last 3 years is performing well in Poland. And before, people grow in the pots and was taking the pots into the shed for the winter. That's how they grow draper before that in Poland. That means you can see by stretching Duke, normally Duke will start in last week on July, I think, in Finland. But by the tunnels, you can stretch the season, and begin of July, the second week of July, you can have already harvest if you grow in the tunnels. With late varieties like Aurora, under the tunnels, I think we'll struggle also to pick full crop in your country. Then I think the last varieties, what I will be looking for you, will be Cargo Liberty and Last Call to try to grow in your country to make sure we can harvest before middle of September or the latest in the third, fourth week of September before season will finish under the tunnels. Then, obviously, somebody asked about Duke. Duke is the most planted variety in Europe, is the earliest varieties in Europe, and still quite good quality fruits, and it's very difficult to find replacement for Duke, as first harvest is the really first fruits in northern climate. The second harvest is already coming with other varieties. That means you have to consider that not always all Duke crop will be early before other varieties. The next variety, what I will suggest for Finland, for sure is Valor. Valor is the variety, the newest in our portfolio, but also is from the open catalog, but also is the most cold hardiness varieties. Been tested in a lot of countries, also in Alps, in Italy, where it's very cold and long winter. We also tested in Michigan, not Michigan, say the in Canada and Washington State, where it's also very cold. Then this variety is performing well in very cold climates, and we not see any risk of frost damage during the winter. That means the cold hardiness, winter hardiness is quite good on this variety also. The next one is Cargo, what is mid-season, late-season variety. That means in your country you will harvest probably somewhere and second part of August. And on open fields probably will go into September. And we can see also last call, I think, needs to be grow under the protection to make sure we can harvest the fruits. All these four varieties, what I present to you, they have quite good winter hardiness, and I not should be the issue like they will be damaged by the winter, during the winter. Obviously, the spring protection when they start flowering is needed for most all varieties. Then very quickly, I think Bart already talked about it, but you know blueberries likes really peat and high organic content in the soil, in the root zone. That is one of the oldest plantation in my colleague Andrea from Italy is pictured quite old already, but this plantation is in Germany where they have already peat in the soil, and you can see how blueberries can grow nicely there, and they can be huge also. But I'm not going to talk about the substrate. I think Bart said quite a lot about that. We have to be careful what we're doing. I really want to stress that pH of the soil when we're planting most of the varieties of the pH of the growing mix, growing medium, have to be, Bart stated 4.5. I would say that is minimum, but we can see now that some peat delivered to from Baltic countries, mostly from Lithuania and Latvia, is quite low pH, even with 3.0. That means I want to be aware that really the best is 5 to 5.5 and is the most safer. That means if you go below 5, just is still okay, but please don't go below 4.5 because we will have problem with uptake of some nutrition. And obviously, it's good to build the beds because it's and cover with the mat, wheat mat, what will help to keep the moisture, and obviously the root development of the roots will be quite good and no weeds. Came revolution. Bart stated that means you can see some old plantation with sawdust. You can see in Chile, Peru special, we growing also in the sand. That is also possible. Obviously, quite a big industry is moving now into pots, as it's much safer and under the protection to have bigger fruits and better quality fruits, as quality really matters, what Ronnie stated. What I can say, advantages of the pots is quite good uniform grow. We can grow high density, and to be fair, also we can have some varieties quite early as a development. That means your investment can come a bit quicker than the open fields, because to have full yield potential of each variety on open fields will take you 5 years. We know in pods under the protection can take 2 to 4 years. That is already quicker return of your investment. And we can say some disadvantage that when grower will come to us, okay, but growing the pods is higher cost. I will say it's not necessary because sometimes to prepare the soil is much higher cost than already grow in the pots. Yes, we need more efficient fertigation system, water management, that means really for pod growing crops, we're really looking to have quite high-tech irrigation system with computers and capillaries and drip irrigation. Obviously, I want to stress, if you grow in pots, if we grow in pots, it's very important to make sure you have good quality substrate ready for blueberries. Please don't use own your mixes because these plants will suffer sooner or later. And well-development substrate for blueberries, we know, is checked for over the years. Just to let you know, my first blueberry plant, what I planted in UK, I planted in 2004 in 25-liter pots, and still is this blueberry in the substrate in the same pot and still is growing. People will say after 10 years, the productivity can be loose, but I will say my blueberry is 16 years old now in England and still have the same productivity year per year. It's about the management of the substrate, of the watering and fertilizing and controlling the climate. I want to show you something. I think was one question how we can grow in pots because can be cold in Finland. I want to say, obviously, in some parts of Poland, we not have so long winter like you, but we have also temperatures up to minus 26, minus 21. And I have to say this pot system is quite good because the soil, when the pot is in the soil beds or even much flatter beds, is helping to keep the heat. Of the soil, and the heat is coming from the soil. That means really if the pot will be frozen and is wet enough, the damage of the plant is not coming. The biggest disadvantage where the plant can be damaged by the cold, where the root system is dry and is no water in it, in no water in the substrate. And also I want to state that the blueberries are quite shallow roots. That means very rarely you're gonna to find blueberry roots below 30-35 centimeters from the top of the ground. Then you can see even in your winter or even in Polish winter where we can have some minus 20 temperatures, the first 30 centimeters of the soil can be frozen. And blueberries are already grown in Poland for over 60 years. And we know in 70s, 80s, when I was born, I have to say we have winter minus 30, minus 35, with about 5 months with these temperatures. That means, and blueberries we grow in the soil. That means, from the really, really cold damage, with the right varieties, I not will be so much worried also to grow in the pots. And the other option is like the Polish growers that was doing up to last 3 years, they're not doing that anymore. They was moving pots into the shed or to the cold storage, to the cover area where they can survive the winter without risk of cold damage. I think that's it from my side. Thank you very much. Thanks, Ronnie.
You're welcome. I don't know if there are any more questions for the Fall Creek team.
It looks like now no questions at the chat. Is there any questions? Does anyone want to ask anything?
Well, you all have our contact details now, so if you have any questions regarding the varieties or technical things, you can contact us, and we are here to support you. So on behalf of my two other colleagues and Fall Creek, I want to thank you to give us the opportunity to present ourselves, our company, and the services and the plans we provide. And I wish you all good luck with your business. So thank you very much.
Yeah, and thank you also for all of the Fall Creek team on my behalf, and it was really interesting presentations. So yeah, I think we'll be in contact if there are any questions and so on.
Yes, thank you so much. Now there is some question coming. Let's see.
Okay, this question is related to the size of the blueberries.
Yes.
So, size of the blueberries is one parameter of quality. What we see in general is that there's an increased demand of, let's say, 60 millimeter plus fruit. That's on the retail part of our business. If we look at how we develop new varieties, we are focused on consistent sizing. So if you look at Vella, like Marius presented, it's a good example. It's a variety which you can pick in two times. But the most interesting on this variety is that the fruit size of this variety is consistent big. So it's all 20 millimeter plus. If you compare that, for example, with Chandler, which is an old variety, the first fruits is always very big. And the two and the three picks after the first pick, then the fruit is always small. So there's no consistency in the size of the fruit. So in general, what we see with all varieties that we are releasing for the last year, size is one of the parameters which is important. And everything must be at least 60 millimeter plus. That's how we see this.
Yeah, if I can add, Ronnie, also when I started with blueberries 16 years ago, the minimum size was 8 millimeters. Now, like Ronnie stated, the minimum size for the to sell fruit somewhere is 12 to 14 millimeters. The retailers want more than 60 millimeters. And when we planting the varieties today, we need to really make sure, because the requirement for the size is rising, then what will be in 5 years? That means plant varieties, what already can be even higher size than at this moment requirement, because your full production, if you plant it today, will be in 4 or 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Marius. I hope that that answered the question.
Okay. Then there's no more questions, I guess. Yes. Okay, thank you very much for all the Fall Creek team. We are very pleased about this. There are more questions coming. Don't leave yet.
Yeah,
This is a question for Marius. What is the best time to cut prune blueberry plants? And if you want to increase sweetness, what is the key fertilizer to get it? Marius? Is Marius already out? I think so. Well, the best time of cutting blueberry plants is when they are dormant. So when we normally start pruning, we start pruning in November, and you can prune until, let's say, March, latest beginning of April. So with the high chill blueberry varieties, we are much more flexible than the mid and low chill varieties. Regarding sweetness, I'm not so technical, so I don't know which specific fertilizer will increase the sweetness of the bricks of the fruit. But in the end, it's not only the sweetness, it's also the balance between acid and sweet where we are looking at also in the breeding. So again, if you have more technical questions, then I prefer to contact Marius directly, and he can answer later.
Yeah, okay, we could do that also. So if there are any more questions about the technical side, so.
Okay.
Okay, so thank you so much. And next, Eric, also should we take a small break, or what you think?
We could take a small break. Yes. if it's 5 minutes too little, or I know that we are behind schedule, but I think that a small break could be okay at this point.
Yes. maybe 5 minutes, and then we can get back, and Erik can start after 5 minutes.
Yes, good.
Okay, great. Okay, so are everybody back online?
Yeah, I think that we can shortly start.
Yes.
Yeah.
So Eric is there ready already?
Yes, I'm ready.
Yeah, I think you can, Eric, go ahead and start. I think so that everybody's back.
Everybody's back. Okay, let's hope so. It's okay. Thank you very much. First of all, a very short introduction of myself. My name is Eric Boltz. I'm working for BVB since 1997. Before that, I have been working as a farm manager in Switzerland, growing strawberries, raspberries, blackberries, etc. And I've mainly been focusing on growing strawberries and substrates since the late 80s, and sidewise also growing blueberries in pots, but my main focus is strawberries. And as I say, since 97, I am working for BVB as a sales guy, consultant, whatever is needed to serve our customers. I will share now my presentation, I hope. Just one moment. Do you see my screen right now or not?
Yes, we can see.
You see my presentation? Okay, because I can't. Oh, yeah, it's here. Yeah, okay. We're going to talk today about fertilizing soil-less grown strawberries. Do you still see the screen right now?
Yes, I can see it.
You still see my presentation screen?
Yes. Okay,
good.
Your face, we see.
It's my face, yeah? That's what I was afraid for, yeah? Because it did work yesterday, but... and what does it do right now?
Now it's... I can see it, your presentation.
You see my presentation?
Yes.
Okay, good. We're going to talk today about fertilizing soil-less grown strawberries. And our main focus is on the next slide. What is fertigation of strawberries? And we will mainly focus on fertilizing strawberries in pots, in containers. And it was nice to have seen the last question of the last session, where the question was, what nutrient is the most important to increase the sweetness of the blueberries? And that is a typical soil planter question, because in the soil, in the early season, you give the plants a lot of nitrogen and the plants will start to grow. And when you're harvesting, you give them extra potassium because that gives extra fruitness, sweetness. That's the basic idea of fertilizing when you are a soil planter. If you look at growing in substrate, growing in pots, it works different. You always have to take into account that all the elements that the plant needs, whether it is nitrogen or potassium or iron or whatever, must be available for the plant, and it must be available in the right ratio between the different elements. So that's what we steer with our fertigation. We make sure that the ratio between all the nutrients are on the right level. And of course, once we have this right ratio between the different fertilizers, we also must make sure that there is enough available in the right concentration for the plants. So that's what we do with fertigation. And today we will dive a little bit into the deep to explain you how we do this. Some of you are raspberry growers, strawberry growers with substrate cultivation already. It may be a bit too simple for those that are purely soil-based growers. it may be a little bit rocket science, but I just hope to keep a little bit in between those two during this presentation. If there's somebody who doesn't understand, or if I go too fast or not clear enough, please ask questions and interrupt us, no problem. As I say, fertigation, it's about how many fertilizers in total and what ratio between the fertilizers. And first, I leave the trace elements out of this at this moment a little bit. We can concentrate on that later on. But if we talk about fertilizers, we are talking about magnesium, ammonium, potassium, and calcium at the left-hand side, the positive elements. And at the other side, it's phosphorus, nitrate, and sulfate. And the first four are positively loaded elements. The other three at the other side are negatively loaded elements. When you have a fertilizer, you will always have a neutral balance. So you need the same amount of pluses as minuses. You cannot say, I'm going to give extra calcium and I'm going to reduce the nitrate, because the calcium would come together with a negative element, with a nitrate or a phosphate or a sulfate. So it's always, if you increase one at this side, you also have to increase at this side. If you reduce something at the left side, you have to reduce also something at the right-hand side. We're going to do some basic chemistry in the beginning with a lot of theory, and I hope at the end of the presentation it will all come together a little bit. So forgive me if it sounds a bit boring and theoretical in the beginning. When you started growing softwood plants in pots, in substrates, you need to have some new knowledge. One of the things is the EC level. If you plant them in the soil, you never talk about EC. You always talk about how many kilograms of nitrogen per hectare, per week, or per year, whatever. In substrate, you want to have a certain concentration of elements, a certain concentration of nutrients available at the root level. And the measurement for that is the EC, the so-called electric conductivity. It is expressed in millisiemens per centimeter. And it's no more or less than an indication of the salinity of a liquid. And in theory, it completely demineralized water with nothing inside, in theory, the EC is zero, but in practice, I'm not exactly right, but in theory, it's that. And if you have 2 × 10 milliequivalents of ions, we will see that later on, EC is about 1 millisiemens per centimeter. In practice also, if you have an average fertilizer, you dose 1 gram per liter, the EC will be around about 1.0. Depends a little bit on the quality of the fertilizer and the composition, but as an indication, 1 gram will give you around about an increase of 1 millisiemens per centimeter EC increase at a standard of 25 degrees centigrade. Then we will talk a lot about millimoles and moles. Soil plants are used to work with kilograms of nitrate or nitrogen, kilograms of phosphate. We are working with moles, millimoles, and for the trace elements, micromoles. You will get this presentation by PDF after this presentation, so you can read it for yourself later on. A mole, it is a figure. It is 6 with a lot of zeros. That's just a number. It's amount of individual elements. So 1 mole of nitrogen is so many, like the different particles of nitrogen. And logically, 1 millimole is 1/1000th of a mole. 1 micromole is 1/1000th of a millimole. Why is this important for you, and especially for those that want to do the calculation of the feed recipes? It's because it's simplifying the whole calculation method. If you have 1 mole of potassium nitrate fertilizer, it consists of 1 mole of potassium and 1 mole of nitrate. If you would have, as you see over there, 1,000 grams, so 1 kilogram of potassium nitrate, it contains 385 grams of potassium and 650 grams of nitrate. So it's very difficult, very complicated to do a calculation and have the chemical balance right at the end of the whole calculation. If you work with grams, the same for monopotassium phosphate. 1 mole monopotassium phosphate is 1 mole of potassium, 1 mole of phosphate. if you do it in grams, you can see that the ratio is completely different than it was with the potassium nitrate. So it's impossible to do a right calculation, impossible, very difficult to do a right calculations if you work with grams. It's way easier if you convert everything to moles and millimoles. In the feed recipes that we use for the neutron solution, we have this list of fertilizers. What is these fertilizers? We can make every recipe that you want. One is missing, I see sulfuric acid, but most of it is there. If you look, potassium nitrate that we had in our early example, it's KNO3. It contains potassium and nitrate. You will always see you have the same amount of pluses and minuses at one and the other side, so you have a neutral chemical balance between the elements. And for instance, a potassium nitrate, if you have 1 mole of potassium nitrate, weighs 101 grams. So these figures you need to know to calculate a feed recipe. All those different fertilizers have a different influence on the EC level of your final neutron solution. You can see here again, potassium nitrate, if you dose 1 gram per liter, the EC increase will be 1.4 millisieverts. If you use 1 gram of monopotassium phosphate, it's 0.7 millisieverts per centimeter. And that's why I said, in average, if you dose 1 gram per liter, the EC increase will be around about 1.0. Later on, you make a fertilizer recipe calculation, and you need to know how many kilograms of fertilizer can I add to my neutral solution to stay within the limits of the EC level that I want to give to the plants. That's why it's important to know these figures here. The second or third, now, an important thing is pH. pH, especially for blueberries, is always a very delicate issue, a delicate parameter. Small explanation, what is pH? pH is a measurement of acidity of a substrate, of course. It is a negative logarithm, it's the way it is expressed. It is an indication of the amount of H plus, of the amount of acid that is in a watery solution. And every point that the pH goes down, it will give you 10 times more acid in a solution. So the pH of 5 gives you 10 times more acid than a pH of 6.
Die hebben we terug.
Bart and Leon, you're online, I think. This is a scale of the pH. You can see the concentration of acid, the concentration of H plus, what gives you a certain pH. And if you have 0.00001 moles of H plus of acid per liter, the pH is 7. If you have 10 times more acid, the pH goes 1 point down. If you have 10 times more again, so it's a logarithmic scale, every time it's 10 times more concentrated. We know that for the blueberries, we want to have a pH in our solution, in our nutrient solution, of around about 4.5 to 5. So we, in most water sources, we find a higher pH. So we will have to add some acid to bring the pH down. And if growers think I have a high pH in my water, so I need a lot of acid to bring it down, it's not always correct. It's very important to make sure that you know what the quality of your water is. And I have an example here on how you regulate the pH with nitric acids. And the example here, if you have a raw freshwater pH of 8.0, means that you have this concentration of acid in this water. If you have also a certain amount of bicarbonates, because most water, except rainwater, most water contain a lot of bicarbonates. In this example, 4 millimoles, what equals 240 ppm. And you want to go down to 6 or 5. We will, in this example, go down to 6. And the question is, how much acid do we need? And to go from pH 6 to, sorry, to go to from pH 8 to pH 6, you will need this amount of acid. So it's 0.0099 millimoles. That's purely to go down in pH level, looking at the concentration of the acids. In this example, however, there is bicarbonates inside. And what happens if you have bicarbonates and you add nitric acid, you get a chemical reaction where you get H2O, what is water, CO2, what is gas, and nitrate. So the nitrate of the nitric acid will replace the bicarbonate in your water. But you can see you have no extra H plus here. And if you do not have extra H plus, no extra acid, the pH will not come down. So as long as you have bicarbonates in the water, when you add nitric acid or sulfuric acid or whatever acid, it will not come down as long as you have bicarbonates in the water. So first, you will have to neutralize all these 4 millimoles of the bicarbonate. And then you can bring the pH down with a 0.099. So in the end, to decrease the pH to 6, this is the amount of acid that you need, 4.0099. So this initial pH, whether it's 8 or 9 or 6 or 7, doesn't matter too much. It's the amount of bicarbonate what is deciding on how much acid you will have per liter of water to your nutrient solution. So you need to know the hardness of the water, the amount of bicarbonates. Then it's the same. Yep. We always recommend to have an irrigation system with an automatic pH control. So your irrigation system must check the pH of the water and must automatically dose the right amount of acid. It is independent of the EC level. If you give a high fertilizer concentration or low fertilizer concentration, the amount of acids will always be the same because it's depending on the bicarbonates in the water. If you have this fixed amount of acids and you have this 4 millimoles of acid in this example that gives you the right pH, and you are going to vary the EC level of your nutrient solution, it will also vary then the ratio between the different elements. Because if you have a full nutrient solution with the right pH, and you would bring the EC down in your irrigation, then nitrate that comes from the nitric acid stays the same. So relatively, you're going to give less of the other fertilizer where the nitrate stays the same. So the ratio of nitrate to the other elements will vary, will change. And we will have some slides later on that explain this a little bit closer. And very important to understand or to know is that the reaction of the bicarbonate and the nitric acid takes time. So it's not in one split second that it all works. And also because the CO2 is gas, it needs space to let the reaction take place. If you have an irrigation system with an automatic pH control, and you have a lot of bicarbonates in the water, then the pH measuring equipment can measure a lot of H plus that comes from the acid, but it does not see the bicarbonate. So it can think, the pH is right because I see a lot of H plus, but the reaction cannot take place. Later on, when the irrigation water comes on the field and it comes out of the dripper, then all of a sudden the space is there and there's time for the reaction. And then this reaction takes place. All the H plus is consumed by the bicarbonates. It's not there anymore. And your pH is way higher than what was measured at your irrigation system. So it's very important to make sure that this measuring of the pH is right. And if you have too much bicarbonate, the whole system is too fast and too small to measure it correctly. And that's why it's important with high bicarbonate levels to do a pre-treatment of the water to already bring this bicarbonate down, so later on it can be adjusted properly with your fertigation system. And that can be done when you fill your reservoir with water to add some of the acid there already, that you add the majority of the acid when filling the reservoir, and from there take the water into the irrigation system. This is on a large scale. It can also be done on a small scale. This is a picture from Germany where in the blue container here, there you have the fertigation rig with the final ECPH dosing. But in the front, you see this day storage tank. When they fill the tank from the well water that they use of there, they already pre-dose the majority of the acids, so it can already start reacting. Then later on, before the water goes to the field, it's fine-tuned by the fertigation rig what's in the container. For the blueberries, you can say, and also for the, other soft fruits like raspberries, blackberries, strawberries, if the fresh water has more than 30 ppm or half millimole of bicarbonates, you need a pH control. If it's lower than the 0.5, then it's no problem because you can manage this with a little bit of ammonium. Also, if the pH is too high and you irrigate with fresh water for a while, for instance, in the substrate, the pH can also go higher and you can also have formation of bicarbonates in the substrate without you dosing it with the fertilizers. So if you would irrigate only a few a certain period with a pH of, let's say, 7.0, means you have a lot of OH minus in the water. It will attract CO2, what is always available in the air, and form HCO3 minus. It will form bicarbonates in the substrate. Because sometimes you get a question from growers, I do not dose bicarbonates, but I do find them in the substrate. How can this happen? And that is because the pH has gone too high and the bicarbonates has been formed from nature in the substrate. And when you have a lot of it, it's very difficult to bring it down again. So especially for blueberries, it's important to avoid this. And it's very important, if you have high bicarbonates in the water, not to give too much fresh water, but also make sure you have, always make sure you have this pH control. We cannot go further down than 5.0 in the irrigation. If you go further down than the 5.0, it's very delicate with the amount of acid that you dose because it can drop down to 3 or 4 very, very fast. And then it's you're going to damage your root system and you're going to block the uptake of some of the elements. So the last part of the decrease of the pH, we do this with our quantity of ammonium that we add to our fertilizer solution. Because we all know if you add ammonium to the fertilizer, it will bring your pH a little bit down because the plant, when it takes up ammonium, it will set free H plus and bring the pH down. And depending on what kind of pH we find in our drainage water or in our substrate, we can vary with the amount of ammonium that we add to our fertilizer schedule. And as last I've written here, the acid source in raspberries, blackberries, strawberries, we always work with nitric acid. For blueberries, it's sometimes very delicate because the nitric acid also gives you some nitrogen. And in some parts of the season, you don't want too much nitrogen because it can give you too much growth and it can block your plants to go into dormancy properly. So that's sometimes we also use sulfuric acid in the autumn time to make sure that the plants go and stay dormant. Here I write again, the ammonium, it's a very delicate thing to steer the pH. We always want to minimize the amount of ammonium, but sometimes you need it for the pH and really only for pH steering. Because if you look at these two sides, it's always difficult to get enough magnesium, calcium, and potassium in the plant. If we're looking at deficiency and plant growth, it's always those magnesium, calcium, potassium, what is the most difficult. We never see in soft fruit problems with phosphate or nitrate or sulfate. We can always give enough of that and the plant takes it and that's no problem. So if we want to maximize the amount of magnesium, calcium, and potassium needs, we need to minimize the amount of ammonium. Only give so much as is really needed for creating the right pH. And that's one of the things that a lot of compound fertilizers you will always find, or mostly find, quite high levels of ammonium, what, to my opinion, just blocks the potential of uptake of magnesium, calcium, and potassium too much. And that's why I prefer to do a single fertilizer to make sure that you can get exactly the right calculation and to minimize the amount of ammonium. You have different sources of water. When you start to grow into pots, into containers, you have to make sure that you have the right water, and you have what I write here, 4 different sources. Maybe somebody else has another source, but the most, the best is the rainwater. If you have rainwater, EC is almost zero. There's nothing inside. It's very easy to calculate everything and to steer your plants. But most of you will work with well water, surface water, maybe even with tap water, if they do not have rainwater available. And then it's very important to check the quality. How is availability? How is chemical and physical, biological quality? With that, I mean, how much bicarbonate do you have inside? Is it clean enough? Does it need to be filtered? Is there microorganisms inside? Is it always the same? If you use surface water, like from ditches, after a heavy rainfall, the composition will be different than after a dry period. And tap water can be used, very stable, but very expensive, of course. So it's something to keep in mind and tend to think about what kind of a water am I going to use. Once you have your water source, or when you're deciding your water source, it's important to make an analysis of this water and make analysis on everything, not just NPK, but all the trace elements. Make sure that you know everything. But sometimes you see all the major elements are okay, but you have a contamination of, I don't know what, high zinc or high copper and high boron. You need to know what's in the water to decide what can I use. The most important parameters is, of course, EC and pH, that I put them in gray because you can correct it with your fertilizer or with your acid. Very important are sodium and chloride. If you have sodium and chloride, the lower the better. Up to 1.5 is workable. If it's over 1.5, if you get to 2, 2.5, we can do special calculations that you can work with it, but you are certainly not able to do recirculation system with the water. You cannot collect and reuse the drains water anymore because that would lead to buildup of too much salt in your water. Same for boron, can be too high in some areas, can also lead to scorching of the leaves and reduced growth. Silicon I put in gray because that's delicate for some strawberry varieties. I am not aware of any problems in blueberries. Iron, important, must be lower than 10 because otherwise it can block your drippers. The iron that you find in the analysis is not available for the plant, so we will always need to do a full dose of iron with our fertilizers. But if it is too high in the freshwater already, it will oxidize and it will give you problems with your irrigation system. The bicarbonate, I put it here in gray, lower than 3. I think with a good irrigation system, you can work up to 3 millimoles. You can neutralize it with a good fertigation system. If it's more than that, you need to do the pre-treatment of the water before you use it for your final nutrient solution. Now, the funny part of this presentation, I tried to do it not too complicated, but this is just an example of how we calculate a fertilizer recipe. And don't look too much at the figure because it's just an example to show you the way of calculating. If we have an aim, that's what we want in our water, of nitrate 10 millimoles, phosphate 2 millimoles, sulfate 2 millimoles, etc., then we're going to calculate how much fertilizer we need to feed our plants. Then we first need, of course, our analysis of what is already in the water, and I've put some figures in. In the night, if you have an aim of 10 and you have already 0.2 in the fresh water analysis, means that in your fertilizer you have to add 9.8 millimoles of nitrate. And the same, if you have a sulfate, you want 2, you have 0.8 in the water, you need 1.2 with your fertilizer. Then we start calculating with our different fertilizers on how many kilograms of fertilizer do we need to put in our mother stock. And the first one, I'm sorry for that, is already the very difficult one. It's calcium nitrate. Calcium nitrate is a very complicated molecule. It contains out of calcium and nitrate, but also a little bit of ammonium nitrate. And if you put 0.3 millimole of this calcium nitrate, gives you 0.3 millimole of ammonium, gives you 1.5 calcium and 3.3 nitrate. The next one we look at is magnesium or sulfate. You can see we need 1.2 sulfate, 105 of magnesium. So if you work with magnesium sulfate, the maximum is 105 because it gives you the maximum for the magnesium. Then you are left over with a little bit of sulfate that you need that can comes later on. First, we look now at our potassium, at our sulfate. So we fill out the whole schedule and I go direct to the end. This is the amount of fertilizers that you need to get to this recipe that we wanted. And then if you look here, we need 2 millimoles of monopotassium phosphate. Monopotassium phosphate weighs 136 grams, gives you 27.2 kilograms of the solid fertilizer. So that's how we calculate our fertilizer schedule. And you see again here, if you raise one element at the negative side, you will also have to raise one element at the positive side. This all sounds, may sound very logical. One thing you have to keep in mind is if you have a recipe like this, it will influence your EC. What's happening with your EC level? And for that, away from the previous calculation, an example with 2 nutrients. If I have nutrient number 1, nutrient number 2, and in the water analysis, I find 0 number 1, and I find 5 of number 2. And for the plants, we know we want 10 of both of them. So we start calculating very easy. We need to add 10 millimoles of the one and 5 of the other one. But this is also always matching a certain amount of salinity, a certain EC level. If we would use this calculation, this schedule, and fill our fertilizer tanks and start fertilizing, it will be okay. But if we would start bring the EC level down, then all of a sudden we see if we would give only 50% of the fertilizer, we see that number 1 goes down to 5 and number 2 goes down to 5 plus 2.5, 7.5. So the ratio that we wanted for our plants, 1 to 1, all of a sudden it's 2 to 3. The other side, if you go up with your EC level, you see that this one will be way higher than that one. So if you change your EC level, you will also have to do a different calculation for your nutrient solution. And of course, if you calculate 1.5 and you go up to 1.6 or down to 1.4, it's not a big problem. But if you make very big steps, you can certainly have an influence. And here, this is a strawberry schedule. This is in milligrams because otherwise the graph is not very nice, where you see a lot of nitrogen in the water because of the nitric acid. No potassium, so all the potassium comes from the fertilizer. The green one is the fertilizer. The dark one is what is already in the fresh water. If you have this calculated at 1.5 and you would go down to 0.8, at 1.5 you can see potassium way higher than nitrate. If you would go down, you see nitrogen is going down, nitrogen, but potassium is going further down. Instead of having the potassium double of the nitrogen, it's lower than the nitrogen. Also look at the calcium potassium ratio. It's also changing completely. So it's very important to make sure that your recipe is calculated exactly for the EC level that you are going to give. And if you have a fertilizer calculation in front of you, it's very easy for yourself to check if the calculation is correct. Because we always calculate with 1,000 liter mortar solution in 100 times concentration. That's the standard that we use for fertilizer recipes. We've seen before that if you have a dosage of 1 gram of fertilizer per liter of water, the EC increases 0.1. That means if you have 100 times concentrated mortar solution, you will need 10 kilograms of fertilizer for an EC increase of 0.1. Ergo, if you have a fresh water analysis with an EC of 0.5 and you want to irrigate 1.7, means that in your calculation, the total amount of fertilizer should be around about 120 kilograms. If you have a calculation what shows there 200 kilograms or 50 kilograms, you know that the whole ratio is completely different than what has been calculated. So it's important that to check that one. Then quickly to some fertigation systems. We work with A and B tank systems mainly. And that is because we need calcium in our feed recipe and sulfate in the feed recipe. If you have a concentration, a high concentration of calcium and sulfate in the same solution, it will form gypsum, it will block completely, it will just be a solid material. So we cannot solve these two fertilizers or these two elements in one high concentrated solution because it will block your system. And they must be always separated in your mother stock. Later on in the system, where they are diluted to the final nutrient solution at an EC level of 1.5, it is not a problem because the concentrations are so low that it will not block anymore. But in the high 100 times concentrated form, it's not possible to have them together. That all leads to a feed program like we designed them. Again, don't look at figures because it's just an example, but we have an A solution and a B solution. The figures that we have seen before in the earlier calculation are now put back in a schedule like this. In the A tank, we put our calcium nitrate, ammonium nitrate, magnesium nitrate, potassium nitrate if needed, and our iron chelate. In our B solution, we put the phosphates and especially the sulfates. And here you can see also the nitric acid is here in this system. If you have no separate pH control, you can add your acid in your B tank. And if you have an exactly 100 times concentration, this will lead to exactly the right pH. But it's way better to put your nitric acid in a separate acid tank and leave it out here. Sometimes it's good to have a bit of nitric acid in your B tank. It makes it easier to solve all the fertilizers, but preferably do the nitric acid in your separate acid tank for a separate acid dosing. Then dosing systems. There's a lot of different dosing systems from Dosatron, from Easy, Preva, or Netafim, A and B, Nutri Jets, or whatever they are called. Some pictures of things that we have seen in practice that are a little bit less sophisticated or very high-tech systems. Always, for all these different systems counts, check it yourself. Make sure that you make always a control from the water that comes out of the dripper. Not in the system, but as it comes on the field out of the dripper, check EC and pH over there, because that is leading for what the plant feels and what the plant is getting. Not what you measure in the barn, not what you see on your computer screen in your office, but what comes out of the dripper, that is the thing that you want to know. And measuring equipment, there are different ways of having that. This is a little picture of drainage collecting system, because you will need to collect your drainage water as well to see what is the EC and pH of my drainage water. And that gives you an insight on what's happening in your pot, because you know what's going inside with your irrigation. If you know what's coming out, then you can judge a little bit on, am I doing right or not? And I put this picture in also because this is also a weighing scale. So it also weighs the weight of the pots, and that helps the grower to decide, or it can even be automated, decide on when is the next irrigation required. And depending on the drains, EC and pH level that comes out of it, it can also automatically adjust the EC and pH what is given on the top. Then the recipes, what should the fertilizer recipe look like? We have, we make in principle three different recipes. And of course, sometimes we need something else if something needs to be adjusted. But see here that it should be growth and flowering. So first we have our growth, so our growth stimulating recipes. Then we go up to the flowering harvest recipes. So that's an overflow and clear. In the growth recipe, you have more nitrogen with more ammonium. Later on at the harvest, the generative schedule, you will have more potassium, a bit more sulfates, a little bit less nitrates. And then the dormancy, the generative or the dormancy winter rest recipe, where we replace most of the nitric acid by sulfuric acid to make sure that the plants are not growth stimulated. So that it's those three recipes, the vegetative, generative, and dormancy recipe, and then with different calculations per EC level. I think that is, when I come to the end of this presentation for growing or fertilizing blueberries in substrate, it's very difficult to give the figures right now on what figures should we have, because it's very much depending on what kind of a system do you have, what kind of a water quality do you have, and also do you have your plants inside or outside, because if you have them outside, you have natural rainfall, it will also influence, of course, the composition of the nutrient solution in your pot. And we look at it from case to case, we just have a look at it, what situation do we have, and what of recommendation of the composition of the nutrient solution do we have, and we adjust it per grower and per situation. And I have no sight on the chat or the app, so I do not know if there have been any questions. I will be open for that right now.
Thank you, Eric. It was very interesting.
Yeah, I hope it was not too complicated, not too boring. It's we'll hear that later on.
You can always contact also to me if you need any advices about the fertilization. I can ask Eric or our own Rolf. So if you have any problems, you can contact me about the fertilizers anytime. Okay, so I guess there are no questions now. So maybe Leon can then begin his presentation.
Yes, hello.
Hello.
I'm Leon Schrijnwerkers, director of Schrijnwerkers Plants and Blueberries. We grow since 50 years already blueberries and plants. I will give you a presentation. I hope it will be clear. If you have questions, you can ask them, and I will answer them afterwards. Schrijnwerkers Plants is a company who already grows blueberry plants and propagates blueberry plants for more than 50 years. There are not a lot of companies in Europe who can say that they grow blueberries and plants for more than 50 years. On the picture, you see my dad and me planting the first blueberry plants, the first plantation. My dad started in 69 with blueberries because he had a mixed company with strawberries, pigs, apples. The apples was not a good business in the 60s, and he thought about another product to grow, which is interesting for the future. And he planted 1 hectare of blueberries with 20 different varieties, so he could see how the varieties grow, how the quality of the berries is, the ripening time. He was one of the pioneers here in the Netherlands about blueberries. He had to find out a lot of things. Of course, there was some experience in the USA. But then the communication with America was difficult, so he found out a lot himself. And in the north of Germany, there were one or two growers who also had already blueberries, and he had a lot of contact. So the company expanded slowly. My dad also started to propagate the plants himself, and on a small scale. Later, my brother and I overtook the company, but the company was too small, and my brother emigrated to Belgium. There he has a blueberry company. He has 17 hectares of blueberries, only blueberries, no plants. And I like the I liked the nursery, the growing of the plants, the propagating very much. So I overtook the plant business also. Nowadays, we propagate and sell 1.5 million plants per year. We have also licensed varieties. Our plants are sold in 35 countries, also in Finland. We sell to all countries in Europe, but also outside of Europe, like Georgia, Armenia, Kazakhstan, and Russia. So it's like an oil spot in the water. It's slowly going further and further. I get sometimes the question, and I got this question already 20, 25 years ago, how long is going to be good in the blueberry business? It's still going good, and there is a lot of interest in blueberries because it's a simple fruit. And with a simple fruit, I mean that, for example, strawberries, they have a short shelf life. With blueberries, you can work much more flexible. Also, your work in the plantation, the picking, can be flexible, because when blueberries are turning blue, they are not ripe. So don't get any stress. When they turn blue, it takes about 4 or 5 days until they are fully ripe. So you can wait with picking until a lot of berries are blue. This is also, of course, very interesting for the pickers. Then they can pick a lot of kilos per hour. Your cost price is also going down very rapidly. So this is very important. Our plants are NAC certified. The NAC is an independent institute in Holland, which checks our mother plants. Our mother plants are in an insect-free glasshouse. So every year they check if they are free from viruses and diseases, and if they are true to name. This is very, very important. A lot of nurseries, they grow some blueberry plants because, it's interesting because there's a lot of demand. They are mostly cheaper as our plants, but that has a reason, because our plants, they are certified, and that's a very important. You can imagine that if you are going to invest for a product for the next 15 to 20 years, then it's very important to have very good, strong quality material, quality plants with certificate. Then you are sure that you have the good quality. And cheap, buying cheap gives a short feeling of I bought something cheap, but the problems, they come after that, and they will last very long. Our plants are propagated by microshoots. Microshoots is a vegetative propagation method. It's done in a climate cell. The small microchips are growing under special LED lights. This is a special mixture of red, blue, and white light, so that they have a nice light to grow. They have also special temperature, and they have special humidity. Later, they are transported to the glasshouse, as you see here on the pictures. In the glasshouse, they are collected, and every 2 months, we transplant from one small multiplate to a bigger multiplate. It means bigger multiplate, larger cups, so that they have space for rooting. They will stay about 1 year to 1.5 years in our glasshouse. They grow over there, so that they are strong, small rooted plants already. And then in the spring, they will be transplanted in pots. And we do 3 kinds of pots. We do 2 liters, 3 liters, and 5 liters, but you will see in the next one different pot sizes what we have. For each step, for example, for the microchutes, we have a separate, different substrate from our supplier, BVB substrates, as in the pot. The most important for growing blueberries is good drainage. It's not the pH, it's not the fertilizer. If the soil or substrate which you have doesn't have good drainage, then you can have a big problems with growing blueberries. Blueberries is a plant with a very fine root system. It has hair roots, really like hairs. If this plant feels that it's too wet, then the plant gets stressed, and then you have you can have the problem with Phytophthora root rot. When you get Phytophthora root rot, it's finished. Then reanimation doesn't help. Better before, make sure that you have good drainage, very good drainage. The plants will grow. The drainage is the most difficult to adjust. Fertilizer you can adjust in any way. Also water you can adjust. You can put acid to the water, everything you can adjust. But the soil where you plant on, or the substrate where you plant in, must be 100%. So you can see here in the spring, the full-grown rooted liners, which are in the glasshouse, are going to the potting machine and planted in different pot sizes. So we have 2 liter is a 2 year old. You see it on a picture on the left. And then we have a 3 liter, which is in the middle, and a 5 liter are 3 year old plants. The 5 liter is on the right. The 5 liter will produce the first year easy 0.5 kilo per plant already. And in the next year, this 5 liter plant will easy give 1.5 kilos per plant. The problem only in Finland is that you have a short growing season. I think that early and maybe middle varieties are good for you. Do not think about mid, late, or late, because they will not ripen. We have already problems with the very late, which is Aurora in our case, to let it ripen, even with the higher temperatures from nowadays. All of our plants are grown on lava container fields. You can see on top the sky picture of our nursery. You see the glasshouse, and in the back, the 5 hectare container field. as I said, the drainage is very is the most important. The last 8 to 10 years, we are growing on lava fields because of the drainage. It's a surface which contains only lava stones, which gives a perfect drainage of water. It's a vertical drainage, so the water comes out of the pot and goes vertically down and is transported to the water basin, which you see on the top picture on the left. It's collected, all the water is collected back and is recycled. This is the law in Holland. So we have a closed system, not a drop of water is going in the soil. So all the fertilizer, the little bit of fertilizer which is in the water, which comes back, we use again. We disinfect the water and use it again. So the watering of the plants is done by rain cars. You see it on the picture down. This is a very good system. You have a uniform, 100% uniform distribution of the water. This is very, very important because in Holland, Holland is known because of the wind. If you have sprinklers, circle sprinklers, which are overhead sprinkling, when you have a little bit of wind, you never have 100% uniform distribution. With the rain car, it's 100% because it's going very slowly over the plants and waters the plants, and it's perfect. Here you see our blueberry varieties. We have Duke as the earliest one, and which is the best one for early. The Duke is already an older variety, but still the best for early. So I would advise for Finland also Duke for the early start. For Finland, it's of course the most important is that it's winter hardy, and Duke is winter hardy. It's very important because I can imagine that you have very strong, you can have very strong winters. If the plants are covered by snow, then you don't have any problem. Then you have a warm blanket over the plants, but the high bush blueberry, they will grow to 150, 2 meters at the end. And I don't think that you have so high snow coverage every year. The problem with frost damage is all the time, not the temperature, but the freezing, the dry freezing of buds, of wood, of roots. So frost protection is the problem that the plant, the root, the bud is getting dry. So, and if they are dry, then they will die. It's the combination of frost, which makes this most of the time dry air, which makes the roots dry and the wood dry. So, but normally we have a lot of customers, for example, in Poland, we have narrow contact with the customers. Those Polish customers, they had also, and they have also winters of minus 20, minus 30, and the plants survive and they have still good crops and good production. But if it's minus 20 for 2-3 weeks and you have an eastern wind for a long time, then you can have a problem. But as I said, when it's covered with snow, then it's not a problem at all. For Scandinavia, we sell some northern varieties, but they are for gardens, like North Country, North Blue, North Sky. They grow very slow and they keep low growing, so they are all the time are covered by snow. But it's for commercial production. It's not good quality. It's not good shelf life. It's not good. We are working together with the best variety breeders. We have licensed varieties from the Michigan State University. We work with the Michigan State University already since 2003. For example, Draper Liberty Aurora, the new one Calypso, Katadin Huron is a licensed variety from the Michigan State University. I think the varieties from the MSU gave a very boost back in 2003. We signed the licensed variety. It took some years before the growers got used to the new licensed varieties, but now they are one of the best in the market, like Draper and Liberty, but also the newer ones. Last year we got two new varieties from Oregon Blueberry. Oregon Blueberry is a respected nursery in Oregon, USA. We got Megas Blue as a new license variety. This is a mid-season variety. I think it has a lot of potential, but all the time, when something new, a new variety is found, you have to test it yourself. It's important that every customer I have tests it in their own climate, with their own water, with their own soil, with their own substrate, that he can see and feel and taste if it's a good variety. So from Oregon Blueberry, as I said, Megas Blue mid-season, and Titanium is a early mid-season. And this Titanium is looks a lot like Draper, and Draper is from the MSU, but Titanium is the turbo Draper. That's why, that's how I call it. A very firm berry, also maybe a good variety for Finland. With Global Plants Genetics, we are also working together. They are dividing the licensed varieties of strawberries, blueberries, asparagus, you name it, around the globe. And the most important, we are working as a company together with the Blueberry Breeding Consortium, with the James Hutton Institute, which is in Scotland. They are working 550 people. They have enormous knowledge about genetics. We are now, I think, about 3.5-4 years together with three other nurseries around the world. We are in a consortium to look if we can find a new licensed variety which is better as what we have. Of course, licensed variety is a licensed variety, but it's not, it has to add something for the blueberry business. It should be better as what we have. When the plants are full grown, the plants are packed and shipped to the customers. So most of the time, from let's say beginning of October, for the customers which are nearby, close by, we can pack the plants because now they still have green leaves. When they are short, packed in a pallet box, you can see on the left how we pack. This was in the spring. You can see that the buds are breaking and that they start to grow. But now still there are leaves on, and you can imagine that when we pack the plants so close together, then a short transport is allowed. For example, when they are two, three, 4 days in the pallet box with full green leaves on, you can have problems with fungi, botrytis. It gets warm inside the pallet box. You get all kinds of problems. So if you have to send further away, then the plants must be dormant 100%. The leaves must be off. Then it's no problem that the plants are 1 week in the pallet box or 2 weeks. It doesn't matter. So this is how the way how we ship two pallet boxes on each other. You see it in the middle. We take care that there is a minimum of air in the truck left. We pack maximal. I have some videos which you can see later on because there's a difficulty to play them now because it's a lot of data. You will see the preparation of the substrate beds and the planting. We use 400 cubic meters of white peat, Baltic white peat. It's important with the white peat that there are that there is fiber in there, that there is structure that is not too fine. That's our experience. Here we plant in 100%. That's my opinion. In 100% or maybe 80% pure white peat. We do not or minimum mix with the original soil. The only thing which is important for me, what the soil should have is drainage, good drainage. I do not care if the pH of the soil is 6 or 5.5. It doesn't matter to me because I plant in white peat. White peat is substrate. So I don't need the soil, I only plant on the soil. But to get a good drainage, the soil must have good drainage. Otherwise, I can have problems when you have a wet autumn or winter or spring that you your roots are going to be damaged by root rot. This is how my packs is made over the substrate beds. You can see that later. Moving images, so a movie is clear, more clear than only pictures. Then you can get a better feeling, but you can see them later. You can see that we have a special company who does this for customers who want to plant blueberries. They are burning the hole in the MyPax and then drill the hole for the pot. When some customers, they call me when this company is coming to them, what kind of size the pot has, which we have sold to them. Then they put exactly the white drill in, so the planting can be done very accurately. You only have to get the pot from the plant and put it in the hole, and then it is exactly planted the way it should be. The logic question is, you are burning the holes in the MyPax. Where is the drip hose? The drip hose is at the very outside of the hill. So when the MyPax is, when they put the MyPax over, the drip lines, two drip lines are also put under the MyPax at the outside. With planting, the people have to pull the drip line from the outside near to the plant. That's very important in the beginning of the growing season, because you only have the pot as roots, and it's very important that the drip line is on the roots near the plant, otherwise it doesn't get any water or fertilizer. You can see here how they are planted. Later on you see it all in movies, then it's more clear. This grower is near by me. For Finland, I think we have to look experiment about a way how to plant them in Finland, because we have here a very high substrate ridge. And you can imagine, if you have every year in the winter your snow, it will be an isolated blanket. But if you do not have snow, but you have frost and eastern wind, and this is 100% Baltic white peat, which is very airy, there's a chance that the roots can freeze dry. So I think the substrate rich substrate hill should be not so high in Finland, because you have more chance that this substrate gets dry too fast. This is the same plantation as you saw previously, the plants. You think it's unbelievable, but this is the second growing year. The second growing year. I was at this customer. This is a young guy, and he has he's very ambitious. He invested a lot of money. He did everything, perfect or almost perfect. And it was unbelievable. The plants you just saw, which were planted, they gave, it was the variety Liberty. Liberty is maybe too late for Finland, but this variety Liberty gave in the same planting year. So these were planted in March. They gave in the end of July, they gave 700 grams per plant already. This is the second growing year, and they gave unbelievable 3 kilos of blueberries, almost 3 kilos of blueberries in the second year. Never have seen it. Coincidence is that we had with a group of blueberry growers, we had yesterday, we had a meeting there, and I asked him what he picked per hectare in the second year, 16 tons, 16 tons of blueberries, quality blueberries per hectare. These, the planting distance of these are 275 times 75. So it's a little bit more narrow. It's about 4,500 plants per. This is extreme, a lot of blueberries, but you can see this is flowering time. You can see a lot of every flower is a berry, and it's very beautiful. Everything is, of course, planted on GPS nowadays, very important, because when you plant blueberries, then it's for minimum 15, 20 years, and you want to look at nice straight rows for the future. Conclusion is that when you are investing in a long-term investment like blueberries, then it's very important that you are starting with a vital, strong, healthy and certified plants. This is the best start. It's not a strawberry plantation which you are getting rid of after 1 year or 2 years. You are investing a lot of money also in substrate, in drip irrigation, everything. So it's the best to get strong plants, and very important, this is very important for Finland, because you have strong winters, you want to start with strong plants, not too soft plants, strong plants, very, very important. I hope I give a clear explanation of our company. If you have questions, I will be gladly to answer these.
Thank you so much, Leon. It was really interesting, and we have a few questions at the chat, so I can translate them. So I think you already mentioned that when the plants arrive to Finland or anywhere else, then you can storage them for a couple of weeks. Is that the timeline? A couple of weeks in the dark storage?
The only problem which can occur with Finland is that the spring starts very late.
Yes.
And I think the spring will start over there at the end of April, maybe half of May. And that's very, very late, because here in Holland, the spring starts in March already. If you want to ship plants, like I said, the best is that the plants are dormant. And dormant means no leaves, no swelling buds, completely dormant, then nothing can happen, nothing. I think because I was thinking what is the best to do with customers which are far away and the spring is starting very late. I think that cooling of plants in pallet boxes like I showed you on the picture is not a good option. I think cooling is mainly for fruit, because if they are very long in a cold store, dark cold store, then they will get out, and then they all the time they were at -2, and then they have to adjust to the spring weather in one time. And I have seen a lot of damage, of cooling damage of plants. My opinion, and I, we don't do any cooling of plants in cold stores. I think the best is that you send, that we send the plants to Finland the latest, the end of February, and then they are still dormant. You can put them somewhere in your shed on a dark space, but then keep them moist, and they will stay moist, I think, but just keep them moist. And then because in the shed it should be not 20 degrees, it should be also about 2 degrees or so, but pack them out, get them out of the pallet box, put them straight up, and then keep them in your shed with cold temperatures, but not frost. Just keep them at 0 to 5 degrees. That's the best, and dark. And in a cold store, I have seen a lot of damage later on in the plantations. The plants don't want to grow. It's not good because, yeah, plants do not like to be very close packed together in a cold store. You can have problems. It's my opinion.
Yes, I have to say I agree, because I have been working in a nursery in Finland, and that is the way that we storage the blueberries, in -2 or zero, something like that, in a dark storage, and they did survive pretty well. Okay, another question. Do you need to have a different varieties to succeed with the pollination?
Yeah, I can make, I don't know, I don't have it in my mind exactly, but I think it's always the best that you have a second pollinator. For example, Duke. In the lecture in books on the internet, it's written that it's self-pollinating, but I think that another variety is always helping a little bit. So I think when you have 5 or 10% of a pollinator next to Duke, would be better. Would be
okay.
Better.
Okay, that's good. Good to know. Okay, there's also a long text at the chat. This crow is saying that they have found out that Duke is quite sensitive to our winters. Blue crop, cold traube, and blue jay are better on our levels in middle of Finland, they are saying.
Yeah, but it's like my father did, the pioneering to look which varieties are good for here in Holland 50 years ago. I think that if I would have the intention to plant blueberries, I would order 5 or some more varieties to test in Finland, of course, yeah, time is an issue. Before you know if it's a good variety, then you are 2-3 years further. Because the main problem in Finland is the cold. It's not like here that we have since 2 or 3 years extreme hot weather, like 38, 40 degrees, which can do damage. The only problem in Finland is the short growing season and the cold. And I think it's possible to grow blueberries, but then in a shorter time window, in a shorter season. So yeah, it's very important to experience that. It's not, there's no user manual exactly for growing blueberries in Finland, because I think you also have different climates in the north or in the south or in the middle. So yeah, you have to find out.
Yes, we need to test the varieties. Yes. And do you have plants available for the next spring, like Duke, for example?
The sales are going very good, yeah, we are sold out, or yeah, almost sold out with Duke. I don't know exactly what we have available, but there's an extreme demand on blueberry plants. I'm not saying that because I have to say that, but it's true. There's an enormous demand, and like I said, we are not only selling to Holland or Germany or Belgium. We are selling to 35 countries, and there's a lot of demand. And for spring, it's difficult to get Duke because it's sold out, I think. But yeah, you can always send an email, and then we can look at that.
Okay. Okay, is there any other questions or comments? Okay, it looks like not. So Minna, do you have anything to say still?
Yes, well, thank you, Leon, for the presentation. It was really, really interesting. And no, suomeksi tässä nyt vielä kehotan, että jos teillä on kysymyksiä, niin nyt voi aukaista mikrofoninkin tai ihan suomeksikin kirjoittaa tuonne chattiboksiin sitten kysymyksiä, jos tulee, niin voidaan niitä tässä vielä kysellä, vaikka nyt on yliajalle menty, mutta yeah, I think that everybody's happy because no more questions.
Well, very clear then, very good. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you very much for coming to our seminar.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
webinar.
Okay. See you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Joo, siinä oli nyt sitten meidän esiintyjät, eli ollaan päästy webinaarin loppuun mun puolestani kiitän ainakin kaikkia osallistujia tähän webinaariin, ja tosiaan nauhoite on tästä sitten saatavilla myöhemmin Laatumare-hankkeen kotisivuilla ainakin, ja myös suomenkielistä tiivistelmää sitten tehdään, että jos osa esityksistä jäi sitten vähän epäselväksi. Mutta joo, onko sulla Eija vielä kanssa jotain sanottavaa tähän loppuun?
Joo, jos on tarvetta kysyä jotain tai haluatte, mäkin voin olla yhteydessä näihin taimistoihin niin kuin jatkossakin, että jos tulee jotain kysyttävää, niin mulle voi kanssa laittaa kyllä viestiä, ja ihan näistä kotimaisista kasvualustoista ja lannoitteista niin tietysti myöskin niin saa oikein mielellä viestiä, ja kiitos kaikille, ketkä oli mukana, ja and also to Bart and Eric, of course, and especially for Bart, because he has done a lot of job with this. So thanks.
Yes, thank you, Bart, for all the organization. So yeah, it was really a really nice thing that this was able to happen today. And yeah, good.
Okei, ei varmaan sitten kuin kiitoksia. Ja...
Joo, ja hyvää syksyn jatkoa kaikille ja mahdollisesti jossain sitten taas tavataankin, kun korona tästä nyt ehkä hellittää, niin jossain mutkassa. Mutta joo, hyvä, ei mitään. Niin.
Kiitos.
Yes.
Heippa.
Moikka. Onko se nyt?